This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Atra-g-g-g-g. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Thank you very much, Fred Foy. Hello, everybody. Welcome to another edition of The Glowing Dial. I'm Big John Matthews, your warm, rotund host. And over there in that sort of direction, I'm pointing kind of to the left of me, but it's radio, and you can't see that. But it's Mr. Steve Archiver Manic.
Hi, John.
How are you?
Okay.
Good. Glad to have you back.
Good to be back.
And how have you been?
Oh, I've been all right. With the opening there, you know, I just thought of something.
What's that?
A little opening there. Well, the Buggles sing "Oh, oh," you know, in the lyrics of the
right
Video Killed the Radio Star song. That's the same first letter of Mo when he says "Gritto" spelled sideways is "Atragagag." That spells, I believe, Atragaga is spelled with an O.
Right, yes. I think it is.
I think the two work together. I think the Three Stooges unknowingly have worked with the Buggles in Oa Oa. O. Atragaga. Sesame Street has been brought to you today by the letter O.
Oh, I see.
Oh, three letters. O, I, and C. Okay.
No, O, I, C.
Oh, high C.
Yes, orange. High C, orange. That's my favorite.
Oh, that's your favorite. That's true. Yes, you love. Here's some tidbits, folks. John loves high C, orange.
I always have, as a kid.
Yeah.
That was the only flavor I liked as a kid. Anyway.
That would be hard. You know, I'll be buying one flavor for you. Very fussy.
Yes. Welcome to The Glowing Dial once again. Steve and I are going to scream out, "It's murder!" Or if you're from Jersey, it's Moida.
Moida.
We have four shows, all with murder in the title. We have Murder at Midnight, Murder by Experts, Murder Clinic, and Murder Well Out. And we're going to get to all of those in just a little bit. So let's get on into the birthdays. We had a Big John health update for you, but we'll save that for the next set here. We'll get right on into the birthday so we can get the first show started sooner.
All right, the birthday list for April the 23rd, we'll start with that date. On that date, Janet Blair was born in 1921 in Pennsylvania, actress in Lux Radio Theater and the Abbott and Costello Show. Then April the 24th, if you share your birthday with Marilyn Erskine, actress Gail Carver on Laura Lawton, and she was Janie Brown on The Young Widder Brown. April 25th, you might find your birthday shared with Edward R. Murrow, famed newscaster. This is London. He did Edward R. Murrow with the news.
Mm-hmm.
April 26th finds the birthday of Vic Perrin.
Oh, yes.
Actor Ross Farnsworth in One Man's Family. And Also, he was Sergeant Gorse in Fort Laramie. And he was the control voice on The Outer Limits on TV. He did a lot of work with Jack Webb on radio and television.
That's right. Yeah, you'll see him in a lot of Dragnets. Matter of fact, the pilot to Dragnet, I think, or maybe it was the feature film. Vic was the bad guy.
Mm-hmm. The only thing I know about dragging a net is you could catch a lot of fish that way.
We used to catch smelt that way. And believe me, after we had him in the car a while, that car smelt.
That car smelt.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
There's our rim shots. Thanks, Ringo.
He's nodding.
Uh-huh. He knows we have to pay him if he utters a word.
Yep. That's right.
And we don't have that kind of money, so he wouldn't do it. And last, we have April the 27th out of the set. Ned Weaver of New York City was born in 1899. He was Dick Tracy in Dick Tracy, and Anthony Loring in Young Widder Brown. There's that show again, Young Widder Brown.
Yeah, that was a famous soap opera. Or op sopra, as our friend John Rayburn would say.
Sap opera. Oh, that would be insulting to
her. Oprah Winfrey hanging around a maple tree or something, right? I don't know.
Sap opera. Right.
Okay.
Play on words here.
Yeah, and we're having some thunderstorms in the background here.
I didn't know we had those planned today. That's interesting.
We don't have a soundproof studio here at Glowing Dial Studios, so if you want to give us some soundproofing, you know, make a donation on the main page, glowingdial.com. There's a little PayPal icon there. So donate some soundproofing.
And you could pay for your pal.
And your pal is Steve and myself.
I certainly hope so. Why else would they be listening?
Actually, it'll be pals, plural.
We could have strangers listening.
And yeah.
Believe me, there's nothing stranger than John and I, but...
mm-hmm. Yes. All right, more celebrity birthdays a little later on in the program.
Set number 2 coming up soon. Mm-hmm.
I think it's time we get started with our first program. It's going to be an episode of Murder at Midnight. It's called Nightmare, from Monday, November 11th, 1946, where it was really thundery that day, and it is today, too. Originally broadcast on KFI Los Angeles and in syndication. Stars Elspeth Eric, Walter Vaughn, Raymond Morgan is our host and narrator. And the sponsor, of course, varied due to syndication. Be different sponsors in different areas of the country. Now, Steve's sitting by with some information on Murder at Midnight. With some dramatic thunder in the background.
And you'd want me to tell you about this program, I suppose, right?
Oh, definitely.
Well, then I'm going to do that. That's what the people are expecting, and I don't want to disappoint them. Here we go. Murder at Midnight. In 1946, Lewis G. Cowan, Inc., a transcribed program house based in Chicago, began creating a series of 52 crime fiction dramas slotted for late-night listening. The National Association of Broadcasters, the NAB, NAB, had begun mandating a curfew of 9:30 p.m. and later for the more violent programming packages of the era. Many of the previously popular primetime features in the post-curfew era found themselves either toning down their scripts or resigning themselves to a post-curfew time slot. Dubbed Murder at Midnight, the intent from the outset was to create a compelling crime fiction drama anthology targeted specifically for late-night listening. Murder at Midnight, while ostensibly a crime fiction drama, was as much thriller as crime drama. The series debuted over the newly coined American Broadcasting Company, ABC, on September 16, 1946, and within 2 years was airing over Mutual and several other independent affiliates throughout the U.S. The show's writers included Robert Newman, Robert Ruskell, Max Ehrlich, and William Norwood, and it was directed by Anton M. Leder, later famous for his television work. That's right. The host was Raymond Morgan, who delivered the memorable lines of introduction over Charles Paul's effective organ theme, Midnight, the Witching Hour, when the night is darkest, our fears the strongest, and our strength at its lowest ebb. Midnight, when the graves gape open and death strikes. According to Billboard magazine, talent and production costs for Murder at Midnight averaged about $5,000 per program, one of the higher costs of canned syndicated programming of the era. But the investment shows. And, indeed, well into almost 6 years of its syndication, the series continued to pull respectable audience shares. The talent included well-known names such as Lawson Zerbe, Carl Swenson, Barry Kroger, Lon Clark, Frank Reddick, Elspeth Eric, Mandel Kramer, Michael Fitzmaurice, Alfred Shirley, and Raymond Edward Johnson, and his wife, among many other well-respected East Coast actors of the era.
And you can hear them applauding up there in the sky for you there, Steve. That's
the heavens are applauding.
Thunderous us, yes. Applause for Steve. But you know, that part of the opening that you read there, when death strikes.
Mo strikes that, too, apparently.
That must have been death striking there. Of course, sometimes death can poke. Or sometimes it could bonk your head.
Yes.
And we could go on and on, but anyway. And you mentioned Elspeth Eric, who's in this episode.
Well, you mentioned Elspeth Eric, too.
Yes, she is. She's done and written some and been in some CBS Radio Mystery Theaters.
Mm-hmm.
Which was an attempt to revive old-time radio between 1974 and 82.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some over 1,000 episodes of that to collect.
You have to try to find them all.
They're out there. They're out there now.
Mm-hmm.
I just wish they could have been, you know, released professionally with really good sound. People had to capture them off AM radio broadcasts.
Well, they have to go through the parole board to release them. Oh,
the parole board. Do I dare ask?
No, it's a release.
Oh.
To release them.
On your own recognizance, yes.
Yes.
All right, Steve.
Well, we have Mark David Chapman running around now after he tried to murder Mr. Reagan, so he got released, so I'm fine.
Yeah, our justice system really needs a lot of revision.
Well, he didn't actually kill him, so it couldn't be a life sentence, but
yeah.
It was a long time anyway. He's been in there more than 30 years.
So. Right. All right, Steve, reach for the McGee machine, which we have, my back is better this week, so we've placed him right here in between us again.
I don't want you reaching, because it's going to definitely strain your back.
Right.
I will reach.
Okay.
Ow! What? I was reaching where I shouldn't have been reaching.
Did Zsa get you?
That was the McGee machine. He's got extra hands sticking out here.
Must have been designed by Zsa Gabor. Anyway, folks, close your eyes and remember, Murder at Midnight. This is called Nightmare from Monday, November 11th, 1946, originally off of KFI Los Angeles and in syndication.
No, don't make me.
I say yes. It's got to be now and here. She's got to die.
Betty.
I say yes. Here. I'll hold her arm.
All right, Betty, but...
No, 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 don't. I don't want to die.
Midnight. The witching hour when the night is darkest, our fears the strongest, and our strength at its lowest ebb. Midnight. When the graves gape open and death strikes. How? You'll learn the answer in just a minute in Nightmare. Now, Murder at Midnight, Tales of Mystery and Terror by radio's Masters of the Macabre. Our story by Joseph Ruskall is one of the most terrifying and fantastic nightmares we've ever heard. Its title, Nightmare.
No. No, don't kill me! Don't kill me!
Helen, what's the matter?
No,
Helen, wake up for Pete's sake. Hey, stop it, Helen, stop it. It's me, it's Ernie.
What? Where am I?
In bed, where do you suppose? It's almost 12 o'clock. I wish you'd let me get some sleep.
Oh, thank heaven. Oh, it was... must have been just a dream. Oh, thank the Lord. Oh, Ernie, it was so real. I dreamed somebody was leaning over me just now with a pillow. Oh, it was horrible. They were trying to smother me to death. And Ernie.
Yeah?
It was you.
What? Oh, me. Oh, that's a beauty. Where's the light? Oh, my God. Oh, you poor, foolish little... Come here, Butch. I'll kiss you back.
No, no, don't touch me. Keep away.
Huh? What is this?
That pillow in your hand.
Oh, for crying out, Bells. Can't I even straighten it out?
Sorry, dear. Gee. Don't mind me, but that horrible nightmare, it seemed so real. Oh, darling, wasn't that crazy? You, the sweetest, gentlest husband in the world.
Then why?
Now, Ernie, now please, don't look so hurt.
Now I can't even look hurt. I just murdered my wife in her sleep, didn't I?
No, you were just about to. I mean...
Oh, no, what the... Everything's happening tonight. Hello. What? Who? Wrong number. And what's more, this is a heck of a time to be ringing. Why, what a nerve. On a night. Thought maybe that was the police you phoned in your dream. Now will you go to sleep?
Ernie Kraft, I'm sure I didn't mean to insinuate anything. I was just telling you my dream. You asked, didn't you?
Oh, you're a character. I guess I'll have to put you in that book I never wrote, too. Well, now what?
That was in it, too.
Huh?
That book you never wrote. You nagged about it so much, no wonder. Oh, and that look when you bent over me like a madman.
Oh.
Ernie, what on earth do you suppose made me have a nightmare?
That's easy. You would insist on eating hamburgers after the show tonight.
Yes, I did, didn't I, when we got out of the movies. Hamburgers, of course. Ernie, they were part of my dream, too. Hamburgers!
Oh.
Ernie, stop punching on that pillow, please.
All right, go ahead then. Better tell me your dream, all of it. Neither of us will sleep until you do. I'll just light this butt. Now, let's have gruesome details.
Well, I don't know if I can remember now. It was all so hazy and terrifying.
Well, what happened before I smothered you with a pillow?
A crazy quilt. Something about your job, and I was a millstone around your neck, and hamburgers, and you hated me, and July 15th.
July 15th?
Yes, I can't imagine what that meant.
Look, start at the start. Why did I decide to murder you?
Because of that other woman, your secret love.
Huh?
You promised her you'd kill me tonight when I was asleep.
My secret love?
Yes, she had you in her spell.
Oh, that's kind of bad casting, isn't it, Butch? I'm the dishes and dustpan type, remember? In the 5 years we've been married, have I ever looked at another...
I know. I told you it was a crazy dream.
Maybe you want me to eliminate my one night a week out, too. My Saturday gin rummy with the boys.
Oh, no.
Who was my secret love? Did she, have a face?
Well, this is the silliest part of it, Ernie. It's absolutely ridiculous. It was that girl, Betty Daniels.
Betty Daniels? Who's she?
You remember that tall, dark-haired artist I introduced you to at Cape Cod last summer? The exhibition.
No, I don't... Oh, wait a minute. Trousers, long cigarette holder,
yes.
Very intense.
Yes, very intense.
But what the devil... What was she doing in your dream? We said hello to her, we walked off, and that was that. Casual.
Yes, I know. I hardly remember myself. I can't imagine why I dreamt of her. Why? No, don't touch me. Don't. No. Oh, that... dream, awful, just so crazy. And yet it seemed to be telling me something, warning me. Strange and weird. You know how dreams are. First, first thing I remember is Provincetown and us looking at the art exhibition just the way we did last summer. Only now the picture was about 10 feet tall and hanging crooked. And then she came along. Betty Daniels. Just the way she did then.
Hello, Helen.
And I introduced you the same as I did then. Only not exactly the same. Like in a dream. You know, silly. Betty Daniels, this is my husband, Ernest. He is very faithful to me.
How do you do?
How do you do? We've never met.
That's a marvelous Goya painting, Helen, don't you think? Or do you prefer hamburgers?
Well, I...
My wife prefers hamburgers, Miss Daniels.
Oh, I didn't know.
Only after a movie, though. Anyway, I'm sure I can't tell one painting from another. My husband's the art lover in the family, I guess. And I just tag along for the fish. Only I don't like fish. I like hamburgers.
I know. You don't wear trousers like I do. You're fluffy.
Betty and I met on the beach, Ernie. She's a painter. Our rowboats got tangled. That's how we met.
Yes, it was all very casual. I hardly remember.
Well,
Ernie and I are going back to New York today. Isn't that a shame? I wish you two wouldn't stare at each other so.
Well, we better run along, Helen. Lots of packing to do.
Ernie has got to get back to his silly old job. He's a reporter.
A reporter? Shouldn't he write a book he never wrote?
Well, imagine. That's what he always says. Well, goodbye. I'm wondering why I'm thinking of you now. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Bye. The scenes sort of dissolve into each other like a kind of dream movie. And I'm trembling with fright because I have a feeling I know how the plot's going to end. The next thing I remember, Ernie, I'm in a penthouse apartment on Park Avenue. Everything zigzag, even the butler. And I'm the maid, Helen, there. And what I'm doing is turning pages for Betty Daniels while she plays the piano. For you, Ernie. Isn't that crazy? Neither of you hardly notice me at all, and I keep trying to open my mouth like that, but it's stuck, and I'm absolutely frozen at what I overhear.
Darling.
Yes, Butch.
Love our loveness.
Out of this world. Ah, this is heaven.
Ernie, do you ever call your wife Butch?
Never. What gave you that idea? Hate the very sight of her.
She's really a little ignoramus.
You're telling me. She prefers hamburgers.
Ernie, do you think she suspects yet?
Of course not. She thinks I'm at a gin rummy game.
Darling, you're blind, but she's not. She knows.
She knows? How'd she find out?
You may go, Helen. Helen, do you hear me? Why don't you go? Answer me. Have you lost your tongue?
Oh, well, there's murder in the air.
How'd she find out, Betty? Tell me.
Darling, do you suppose she doesn't know what happened last summer in Provincetown? After we all said goodbye... You came to look for your cigarette lighter. She knew you hadn't lost your lighter, that you'd come back to ask me for my New York telephone number.
She knew?
Of course, intuition. She knows we've been having a secret affair ever since. I can't go on like this. I'm tired of being just a gin rummy excuse. Ernie, if you love me, you'll do what I promised.
But I pity her so.
Don't be a fool. Isn't it her fault you never wrote that book you never wrote?
It's true. She wouldn't let me give up my job. She's a millstone around my neck.
Then get rid of her, Ernie. Get rid of her, and I'll bring your genius to the world. I've plenty of money, and you can give up reporting and write that book. Fulfill your destiny.
Fulfill my destiny. Oh, Betty, you'll help me.
Yes, but only if you forget July 15th. You'll forget about July 15th. It won't mean a thing to you from now on.
Not a thing, I promise.
And you'll do away with it. The way I told you.
Yes, like you told me.
The pillow.
The pillow. Don't let her hear.
Just look at her standing there at the piano. You've been spying on us, Helen, haven't you? Haven't you? Answer, have you lost your tongue? Oh, don't try to fool us. We know you're the real Helen and not the maid. She's heard everything you've said, Ernie. So we'll have to kill her now.
Unless she gives me a divorce.
Will you give him a divorce? Answer or we'll finish you right now. Hello. Here's the pillow, Ernie. Right now. I'll hold her on.
Answer, Helen. Don't make me do it. Answer, Helen. I pity you, but I hate you.
Let her cry. Look at her. Stricken dumb. Her mouth's moving, but she's not saying anything.
What are you trying to say? Helen, please don't make me do it. Will you give me a divorce? Tell me. Tell me.
Ernie. Ernie, stop. Fools we are. Do you want her body found here? I'll hang for it.
She's got to die. She's got to.
No, not here. Not like this. There must be some other way. Later tonight, Ernie. After the movies. Hamburgers. She'll get hungry for hamburgers. She's bound to. The waiter will ask her how she wants them. That'll give you the clue. And then, when she's asleep... and they'll find her in her bed. The perfect crime. Don't you see, Ernie? Hamburgers.
A frightened girl reliving a dream that was more terrible than any reality. A dream that could even become more terrible as the clock on the mantle ticks on and the hands draw closer to 12 o'clock and...
Murder at midnight.
And now back to Murder at Midnight and Nightmare.
Well, let's hear the rest of this dream of yours, Helen. What happened after that?
Well, it was after that that it really got bad. It was so crazy, but so real. I don't know what stopped you, Ernie, kept you from killing me then, but you didn't. And still, I knew you were going to. You dragged me out into the street and then into a movie and then out again. And I looked at you and you were crying because you'd made up your mind to finish me off when we got home.
You should have let me write that book, Helen. You should have.
And I kept crying, I love you, Ernie. Don't kill me. Please don't kill me tonight.
But I've got to. I've got to. I pity you, but I've got to.
And you pulled me along through the streets again. I was terrified. And then I saw a policeman and I cried to him, Officer!
Yes? What is it, lady?
Please save me. My husband here wants to kill me.
Oh, wants to kill you, eh? Why, that's a crime. A felony.
Oh, why are you joking? Don't joke about it. Do something, please. I'm frightened to death.
Don't pay any attention to her, officer. She's dreaming.
I'm not. Don't believe him. He wants to wait till I go to sleep tonight. And then as soon as I fall asleep...
Oh, come now, lady. He wouldn't do it to you in your sleep. Why, you're cute. Not in her sleep now, would you, mister?
Of course not, officer. Not in her sleep. As a matter of fact, we're stopping off first for a hamburger. She's hungry.
No, I'm not. I mean, I am, but I don't dare. I'm starving, but I don't dare. He's just waiting for me to order one, officer, to see what I'll say. And then he'll take me home and kill me.
Oh, lady, stop. Sure, and you're breaking me heart.
Come along, dear.
No, officer, please protect me. Don't let him take me, please.
Come along, I say. Darling.
And then we were in the little lunchroom in our neighborhood, around the corner from our house, sitting on stools. The counterman came over to us. He winked at you, Ernie, and you winked back at him, and he said...
Evening, folks. What do you have?
You looked at me, but I shook my head. I shook my head, and the tears were streaming down my face.
I tell you what, Joe. Make it 2 hamburgers.
Right. Rare, medium, or well?
Medium, Joe. Make mine medium.
Right. And the little lady?
How do you have yours, Helen? How do you like yours? Make hers medium, too.
2 hamburgers, medium.
2 medium, coming out.
And what do you have on them, folks? Relish or onion?
Relish. Make mine with relish, Joe.
Right. And the little lady?
Man's talking to you, Helen. How'll you have yours? Answer him, I say. Answer him. This is it. How'll you have yours?
No, I won't tell him. If I do, you'll know how to do it, so I won't tell him, I won't. The next thing I dreamt, we were home again, sitting in the parlor, everything exactly the same, Ernie, just like tonight before we went to bed. But in my dream, I was sitting paralyzed, in a cold sweat, waiting for the word from you that meant my death.
Well, Butcher, I guess we better hit the hay, what do you say? What do you say, darling?
No, Ernie, did I tell that counterman how I wanted my hamburger served?
Of course, dear.
What did I say? I can't seem to remember.
Oh, I forget to come along to bed.
No, I don't want to go to bed yet. Please don't make me go to bed. I'm scared.
Helen. Come to bed, darling. Like a good little girl.
We went to bed. And then
when you said...
And now, lights out, eh?
I tried to think of everything I knew to keep awake. I wondered whether I ought to count to 100 or whether counting would put me to sleep. I tried not to count, but I felt myself getting sleepier and sleepier.
Asleep, honey?
I heard, but I pretended not to. I fought to keep my eyes open. I knew I would die if I closed them.
Asleep, Butch?
I didn't answer. I couldn't if I wanted to. I was so scared. And then pretty soon I heard you stirring ever so quietly. And in a moment you were leaning over me. Oh, Ernie, I know it was just a dream, but it was so real. And there was hatred in your eyes, and there was a pillow in your hand, and I knew you were going to do it right then, and I...
Oh, that's a few things, honey. Oh, my aching back. Darling, when you have a nightmare, you sure do it up golden brown and crazy.
Wasn't it crazy? Oh, darling, wasn't it mad?
Oh, wait till I tell it around the office tomorrow. Oh, this is too good, Jim.
But, Ernie, how does a person have a horrible dream like that? What does it mean?
Oh, it's a cinch. I'll interpret it for you. And without a dream book,
you
too.
You will? Well, go on then, Ernie. Tell me.
Okay, then here it is. First of all, a dream always means the opposite, right? You ever hear that?
Yes, I have. That's right, it does.
Which means I must love you simply awful. Granted?
Granted, silly. But goodness, what about the rest of it?
Easiest thing in the world. Darling, where'd we go tonight?
To a movie.
What kind of a movie?
It was a murder story. Gee, that's right. Do you think that was...
Now, don't interrupt, Butch. Who was starring in the movie?
Betty Davis.
Repeat the first name.
Betty.
And the villainess in the dream, my secret love, the girl we met last summer, was also Betty. Betty Daniels.
Oh!
Well, that gave you Betty on the brain when you went to sleep tonight and movies and murder... And those hamburgers you did stop to eat after the show wrapped up the whole sequence. And no wonder. They're still lying on my stomach, too.
Well, what was the pillow doing in it?
Sweetness and light, what were you talking about early this evening? That chore you intend to get after someday?
Oh, yes, I've got to stuff the pillows. They're caved in the way the feathers have come up.
Right, that's your pillow you had on the brain, which brings me back to the hamburgers.
Yes, I was going to ask you, I mean, that nonsense of how did I want my hamburgers, what did all that mean, for heaven's sake?
Precious, how did you order your hamburgers done tonight, remember?
No, I can't recall. Oh,
of course you can. Think now. How do you almost always order your hamburgers?
Well, smothered in onions. Oh, Ernie, of course. Smothered in onions. Smother, pillow, smother with a pillow.
Yes, check.
Oh, my heaven's sake, alive. Oh, my gosh. So that was it. Oh, if that doesn't beat... Ernie, that was wonderful. Really. The way you did that, figured that all out. I think you'd make a terrific detective.
Yeah, so I'm a police reporter. Close enough.
Darling, it's made me think, though... But maybe I have been a little bit selfish.
What do you mean?
Well, that book you always wanted to write. Maybe I ought to let you give up your job and try.
Oh, and have us both starve? Nuts. Anyway, in my sane moments, Helen, I've always known the truth. I'm no writer. If I had it in me, it would have come out of me, job or no job.
I could go back to work again, you know. I could take up nursing again. It was pretty hard,
nonsense. I won't have it. I won't say any more about it, and that's fine. You're a swell guy, though, Butch. To offer to.
Oh, there was one thing more, Ernie.
Hmm? Yeah?
What do you suppose that was all that about July 15th, about your forgetting July 15th? What did that mean, you know?
Yeah. Don't you?
No, I can't. It does seem familiar, but I can't seem to... Where are you going?
Get something out of my wallet. Wait a minute. What's the date of our anniversary, Helen?
Hmm? July 15th, of course. Tomorrow. What was that?
Right. You've had that on the brain, too.
Oh.
Here. Little present for you, darling.
Oh, what on earth? Tickets. 2 railroad tickets to Montreal.
Right again. We're taking an anniversary trip. I wanted to surprise you when you woke up, but... Well, anyway, happy anniversary, baby.
Oh, Ernie, oh, you great big precious darling. How can I ever? You
didn't forget. You always did before, but this time you didn't. Oh, Ernie, I just can't stand it. First that dream and then finding out that it did mean just the opposite.
No, 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 Helen, don't.
It's so sweet of you. I'm so thrilled. Montreal, where we had our honeymoon, and you haven't forgotten. Oh, Ernie, I do hope I've been a good wife to you. And if there's anything I ever... I mean, if you want me to, I can always change.
Oh, darling, I wouldn't want you any different for the world. I want you to stay just the same sweet little girl I married. And now, let's get some shut-eye, huh? Lights out?
All right. And I'm going to put the tickets right here under the pillow. And have a happy dream for a change.
Ah, good night, Butch.
You haven't kissed me? Good night, dear.
Asleep, darling. Darling, are you asleep? Hello?
Ernie?
You shouldn't have phoned before, Betty. She was still awake.
I had to know. Is it done?
Not yet.
You got the tickets?
Yes.
It has to be tonight. You promised.
I know.
Is she asleep now?
Yes. Just gone off.
Then what are you waiting for?
Nothing. I'll do it now. Right now. As soon as I hang up.
Putting down the phone, Ernie turns and picks the pillow off his bed as the clock finishes striking 12.
Murder at midnight.
Remember to be with us again when death appears out of the darkness, wearing the face of one you know, and the clocks strike 12 for...
Murder at Midnight.
The part of Helen was played by Elspeth Eric. Walter Vaughn was Ernie. With music by Charles Paul, Murder at Midnight was directed by Anton M. Leder.
Top of the morning to you. This is Arthur Anderson. But let's pretend I'm Lucky the Leprechaun. You're listening to the Glowing Dial. Oh, you like the Glowing Dial. For us, said Arthur Anderson, it's magically nostalgic. That doesn't quite scan, does it? But you know what I mean.
Big John and Steve, and we are back with you. Hope you enjoyed that episode of Murder at Midnight.
I did.
That was called Nightmare from Monday, November 11th, 1946. Originally over KFI Los Angeles and in syndication. We've got three more programs with the word murder in the title as Steve and I scream out, "It's murder!" On this episode of The Glowing Dial, you yodeled a little bit there at the end of that one, didn't you, Steve?
I learned that from my old lady who.
Little old Doctor Who, or...
No, is it old lady who? Yeah, that was Would Doctor that Who's
his,
mother.
His mother, yes.
Old okay. lady who.
Old lady who. Is a Slim Whitman solo coming up next? I just want to, you know, make space for it here. And
yes, her name was Rosemary.
when she was young, it was Baby Rosemary. I have no idea what we're doing here, folks. I think we're continuing with the show.
We're trying to, anyway.
Before we get into our next program, we have some more birthdays, and I want to lead this one off with a dedication of sorts. I want to dedicate this episode of The Glowing Dial to the memory of one of the greatest comics that I have ever seen, that a lot of us have ever seen. Mr. Don Rickles passed away. As we record this a few days ago, he passed away at the age of 90. And I didn't know about it right away. Steve sent that to me in an email, and he said, by the way, Don Rickles passed. And you know, folks, I sat there and I cried. I watched a lot of YouTube stuff, some of the, you know, the best of Don on The Tonight Show, and there was a Friars Club roast in its entirety where they roasted Don. And I watched that, and I was laughing, I was crying, you know, and just bidding Don goodbye in my own way. Now, he was good friends with Bob Newhart, who is still with us, so that must have hit Bob and Ginny, Bob's wife Ginny, it must have hit them pretty bad, because they were very, very close friends, used to take trips together, and the YouTube is just full of Don Rickles tributes right now. Some of them, I don't watch the stuff that's only like 30 seconds or a minute and a half. I want full-length programs, or at least a full appearance on a program. They even had Jimmy Kimmel starting off his show, and he was choking up. I mean, he was doing his best not to just burst out crying right there, and he did break up a few times. So, Don Rickles, rest in peace. Thank you, sir, for all the laughs and all the kind-hearted insults.
May his hockey puck last forever.
His hockey puck, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yes, well, we also had the last game played at Joe Louis for our hockey team here in Detroit, the Red Wings.
Oh, okay. Right. So
there's a double meaning for hockey puck here lately.
Yeah. Well, on to our other celebrity birthdays. On April the 28th, 1878, Lionel Barrymore came into this world in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Of course, he was an actor. He was Leonard Gillespie in Dr. Kildare. Played Ebenezer Scrooge in A Christmas Carol, and so many other things. And Curly from the Three Stooges always thought he looked like Barrymore. Ain't I getting to look more and more like Barrymore? Yeah. April 29th, 1903, Frank Parker, New York City. He was a singer with the A&P Gypsies, the Frank Parker Show, which he had after his appearances on the Jack Benny program.
I never went to I went to A&P lots. I never saw any gypsies every time I shopped there.
Oh, well, maybe you didn't shop there at the right times.
I guess not.
I like the spoonerism blooper that exists with that. So go to your A&P feed store.
Oops.
April the 30th, 1912, Miss Eve Arden, Our Miss Brooks.
Oh, I just caught an episode of that on the local rerun channel thing mm-hmm. on cable. I'd never seen a whole episode of it before.
Oh, I used to, yeah. Mill Valley, California, the same place the character of B.J. Honeycutt from MASH used to come from there. Of course, she was Connie Brooks and Armis Brooks on radio and TV, and she was in the film Grease as the, was she the principal? I think she
yeah,
was the principal.
Yeah, she was the principal, yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And even in the sequel, I think she reprised her role there, too, and so many other things. Wonderful actress. May the 1st, 1918, Jack Parr was born in Canton, Ohio. Comedian, of course, and host of the Jack Parr Show, Take It or Leave It. And he hosted The Tonight Show on TV before Johnny Carson
he did
was
4 years, I think.
Given
yeah.
the show, yeah. And then on May the 2nd, Bruno Wick from Krefeld, Germany. He was an actor. He was Ming the Merciless on Flash Gordon and Mr. Fowler on The Goldbergs.
Mm-hmm.
Ming the Merciless, a role that in the films Charles Middleton brought to life. And Charles was, if you've seen him there, he was in a few Laurel and Hardy's too, as the, not necessarily the bad guy, but nemesis of Laurel and Hardy. And he had a way of singing his lines. I'll get you, you know, yeah. Something like that.
Uh-huh.
That was just his style. So that's the birthdays for this segment. And if you want more birthdays, folks, we've got you covered. Our friend Ron Sales has a blog, and he's got them for the whole year, so you can see what celebrities you share your birthday with.
Wretch.
Mm-hmm. All you have to do is go to glowingdial.com. On the menu to the left, click links, and there you will see. You would be taken to a page where Ron's link is, and head on over there. See who you share your birthday with, and tell Ron, drop him an email and let him know what a good job he's doing. And make sure you thank Ron for collecting all this information for us. Tell him Big John and Steve from the Glowing Dial sent you on over there.
Be sure you have the stomach for it when you're being taken someplace.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And, okay, now that that's done, we still have a Big John health update to come up, and we're going to find out what Steve's been up to lately. We thought we'd break this information up a little bit since I looked, and as I've been doing the editing of these shows, and we took, on the average, a good 15 to 20 minutes before we played our first old-time radio show.
Right, people fall asleep. I'm like,
yeah,
we're just rambling on and on. Maybe they just want to listen to the shows and they don't want our banter. Some people love our banter, but not everybody does, you know? It would be different if we were Tony Banta, but that's on and on and on.
Okay, Steve.
Did I make my point? I thought I did a good example.
I think so.
Right. Yes.
Yeah, I'm going to pour some cold water over Steve, and then we're going to get on with the show.
Right.
I won't do it till we get into the show, so it's off mic, you know. Because you don't want to hear the sound he makes when he gets cold water poured on him.
I don't want to be isolated.
Oscillated or isolated? Okay.
I'm a big blowhard. Why not oscillate? I don't care.
Yeah, other people have said different things. But anyway, Steve, we have an episode of Murder by Experts to bring you. And that is called The Dark Island. It's from Monday, August the 8th, 1949, originally on Mutual, starring Gertrude Warner, Bernard Grant, and Maurice Tarplin. John Dixon Carr is our host and narrator. Bill Tonkin is announcing, and the show was sustained. And as Steve will probably mention, the show was produced and directed by Robert A. Arthur and David Kogan, who also did the story adaptation. Now, these guys were radio powerhouses, known for shows like The Mysterious Traveler, The Strange Dr. Weird, and The Sealed Book.
Well, I'm not reading that sentence then. Okay.
Yeah, I have a habit of doing that, repeating stuff that Steve's about to say. So, Steve, give us the rest of the information we've got over there on Murder by Experts.
Murder by Experts offered tales by the leading writers of mystery fiction chosen by masters of the genre. Highly charged plots of crime and passion that turned on emotion rather than gimmicks. The series was produced and directed by Robert A. Arthur and David Kogan, which you mentioned. The writing team responsible for several other memorable radio series, including the ones that John just mentioned.
That's right.
The show's host included masters of mystery, often John Dixon Carr and Brett Halliday, and sometimes even Alfred Hitchcock. Good evening. As he breathes into the microphone. Cast members were made up of mostly New York radio personnel. Oops, some of these I read in the last murder program. They must love doing murder stuff. Recognize some of these names here. Lawson Zerbe. I mentioned him before, remember? He's there again. Bryna Rayburn. Ian Martin. Bill Zuckert. Eleanor Phelps. Miriam Wolfe. The Witch's Tale. Maurice Tarplin did Mysterious Traveler. Roger DeCoven. Gertrude Warner. Larry Haynes. Oh, there's a familiar name. Ralph Bell and Marilyn Erskine. I believe I mentioned Marilyn Erskine in the other murder one as well. The series was sustained and broadcast on Mutual from June 13th, 1949 to December 17th, 1951.
Ta-da. Okay, that's a briefer bit of information than we usually have here.
Sometimes we don't have a lot to go on.
That's right. All right. Well, now that we got that information and we've given you the second set of birthdays, I think it's time that we get into this program. So, Steve.
Do I have any lines in this program?
Oh. Take the position and buy the McGee machine and we'll get this thing going.
Come on, baby. Work for me. Success.
It must have known that you said it nicely and not ordered it.
Yes.
I have to ask nicely. All right, folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember Murder by Experts. This is The Dark Island from Monday, August 8th, 1949, originally over Mutual.
Murder by Experts. The Mutual Broadcasting System presents Murder by Experts with your host and narrator, Mr. John Dixon Carr, world-famous mystery novelist and author of the recently published bestseller, The Life of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle.
Good evening. This is John Dixon Carr. Each week at this time, Murder by Experts brings you a story of crime and mystery which has been chosen for your approval by one of the world's leading detective writers. Tonight, our guest expert is the noted mystery novelist William Irish. From the many thrillers he has read and enjoyed, Mr. Irish has selected a most unusual story of mounting terror by Sidney Morris. And now we present Gertrude Warren and Bernard Grant in The Dark Island. Look now at the small tree-covered island, lying in darkness several miles off the rocky coast of Maine. Now and then, the moon breaks through the clouds, revealing for a few brief moments the figure of a girl, pacing back and forth on the boat landing by the water's edge. She watches anxiously as a small launch approaches the island.
Why doesn't he hurry? Why doesn't he hurry? I won't stay on this island another moment. Not another moment.
You all right, ma'am? I saw your emergency flare from the mainland. I came right away.
Oh, thank heavens you're here, Sheriff. I couldn't have stood it another minute. I was going out of my mind.
Why are you crying? What's wrong? What's the trouble, ma'am?
Take me to the mainland. Take me to the mainland.
Oh, sure, ma'am, sure. But don't you think
please,
first you better...
take me away from here. Take me away!
Here, let me help you in. All right, sit over here, ma'am. Before I shove off, is there anything you want from the lodge?
No, no, just get me away from here. Get me away!
Just as you say, ma'am. Get the light. Yeah. Ma'am, this is my office. And have a seat.
Thank you.
Now suppose you tell me what's happened, huh?
It's like a nightmare. A confused nightmare. All of it. I'm so mixed up. I can't tell any longer what part of it was real and what's my imagination?
Just calm down, ma'am. Tell it to me in your own way. Now, think back. Must have had some starting point. Things generally do.
Some starting point. Yes. Yes. It began that morning I saw him for the first time. Could it have only been last spring? A small boat put in at our dock, and Philip came walking up the path to the lodge. I can see him now, tall and sunburned, with the wind blowing through his blonde hair. He was the handsomest man I'd ever seen, despite the long, cruel scar on his cheek. He smiled for a moment as he saw me, and then he spoke.
Hello there.
Hello.
They told me over on the mainland that you have an empty cottage here. Would you care to rent it to me for a few months?
Rent the cottage? Why, my father would never have rented it. The people on the mainland know that.
Yes, they told me, but this island looks so peaceful, so secluded. I thought I'd ask personally. Do you think it would do any good at all if I were to speak to your father?
Oh, my father died 3 months ago.
Oh, I'm very sorry. They didn't mention that back at the hotel.
It's quite all right.
I hope you won't think I'm being inquisitive, but who else lives on this island?
No one. I live alone.
Alone?
Yes.
Isn't it rather lonely?
Oh, no. I'm quite used to being alone. Even when my father was alive, I was alone most of the time.
What about visitors from the mainland?
Oh, Father discouraged them. As a result, no one ever comes here. Father even educated me himself. He was a doctor.
Really? Well, so am I. My name is Duval, Philip Duval.
Oh? Well, I'm Eve Winters.
Winters? Uh-huh. Your father wasn't by any chance Dr. Malcolm Winters, was he?
Yes.
Well, this is a surprise. I've read both of your father's books on criminal psychology.
Oh?
Oh, yes, he had great perception, great understanding of the criminal mind.
Well, I know very little about it.
Oh, yes, of course. I do hope you'll forgive me my curiosity. But, why did your father give up his position in the medical world and simply disappear without a trace?
I don't know.
I should very much like to have met him. You see, I, too, am writing a book on criminal psychology. That's why I need the cottage, so I can work undisturbed.
Oh, I see.
Yes, it's just impossible to work at the hotel. There's so much talk going on about the murder that
murder?
I find...
Murder?
Yes. Haven't you heard?
No. I'm afraid I know very little of what happens on the mainland.
Well, perhaps it's just as well. There's been too much talk about it already.
Oh, no, please. I want to hear about it.
This morning, a young girl was found murdered. She'd been slashed to death.
Oh, how horrible.
It was another scalpel killing, exactly like the other two.
You mean there were others besides the poor girl found this morning?
Yes. In the past 2 months, three women have been killed in identical fashion. Their throats cut by a surgeon's scalpel.
A surgeon's scalpel?
Yes.
Well, have they caught the murderer yet?
No. The authorities were questioning everyone this morning, but they'll never catch him. He's far too clever for them and their stupid methods. They don't realize that they're dealing with a mind that's... Seems I'm already giving a lecture. Goodbye, Miss Winters, and if there's anything I can do for you, I'm staying at the Stratford Hotel.
Well, thank you, but I never go to the mainland.
Goodbye.
Doctor?
Yes?
There's really no reason why I shouldn't let you use the cottage. So, if you still want to...
That's most generous of you. You have no idea how much this means to me.
You can move into the cottage any time.
Well, it so happens that everything I own is in the boat. So there's no need for me to go back to the hotel.
Oh, I see.
I'm most grateful for the cottage, Miss Winters. And I promise I'll do my best to keep out of your way.
Within an hour, he'd moved in. A week went by, and except for the glimpses I'd caught of him writing at his desk by the window, I saw very little of him. And then one day we met at the well, and soon we were meeting every day. Strange the way one can be so lonely, and then suddenly life becomes wonderful, each day happier than the last. But one day Philip would finish his book and leave, and once more I would be alone.
Eve, where are you?
Oh, here I am, Philip.
I just received a letter from my publishers. They like the 30 chapters I've already sent them, and they're going to publish the book as soon as I complete the rest.
That's wonderful, Philip.
You haven't much more, have you?
No, just a final chapter on the Bluebeard complex, and it'll all be finished.
And then, where will you go?
Go? I've been so busy this past month that I hadn't thought about it. Somehow I've come to accept this island as my home. Perhaps it's come to mean home because of you, Eve.
Oh, Philip.
Eve, I'm a fool. I've been so busy with the book, I've never stopped to tell you how much I love you. How much I need you.
If you only knew how much I wanted to hear you say that.
Eve, darling, will you marry me?
Will you marry me? Oh, I was happier than I thought anyone could be. A few days later, we went to the mainland and were married. We spent only a few hours on the mainland, for after 15 years of living on the island, the townspeople, the noise and constant movement were more than I could stand. Philip and I returned to the island that same day. The weeks slipped by swiftly. Philip worked on his book, and I looked after him. And then one night, after we'd been married a month, I was awakened by Philip.
Eve,
huh?
Wake up, what? Wake up.
Oh, what? Oh. What am I doing standing here by the clothes closet?
I awoke to find you getting out of bed. Your eyes were wide open, darling, yet when I spoke to you, you didn't answer.
What?
You just walked over to the clothes closet as though in a trance.
And then you awakened me?
Yes.
That's strange. I've never walked in my sleep before.
Well, don't worry about it, darling. You'd better go back to bed. We'll talk about it in the morning.
But with morning came the sun, and the night was quickly forgotten. Philip continued to work on his books and read unpublished medical papers left by my father. And then one morning, shortly before dawn, I awoke to find Philip's bed empty, unslept in. I quickly dressed and went to his study. He was sitting at his desk, his eyes bloodshot, staring into space. I placed my hand on his shoulder.
Eve!
Darling, is anything wrong?
Wrong?
Yes, you've been here all night. What were you doing?
Why, I was reading your father's books. And the material he left at his death.
Philip, there is something wrong, isn't there? I feel it. It's in this room.
There's nothing wrong, Eve. It's just your imagination.
Are you sure?
Yes, of course I'm sure.
All right, darling.
Eve?
Yes?
Tomorrow is the first of the month. I promised my publisher I'd be in Boston on the first to discuss my book. It'll mean a trip away from the island for a night.
Well, when do we leave?
Eve, would you mind very much if I were to go alone?
Alone?
Well, I'll really be tied up with my publisher most of the time. Besides, you know how you hate the noise and confusion of the mainland.
Of course, Philip. I suppose it would be foolish of me to go along. You'd be so busy.
I knew you'd understand.
When do you think you'll leave?
I'll have to take the noon train to Boston. I just have time to catch it. I'll be back early tomorrow evening.
With that, he was gone. Something had happened that night. Something that threatened our marriage, our future. And I didn't know what it was. How empty the lodge was with him gone. I returned to the study and began to straighten out the papers on his desk. Then, as I opened one of the drawers, I saw them. Hundreds of clippings from newspapers all over the country, and all of them about the scalpel killer. Clippings? Why had he collected them? Why? And suddenly I was afraid to think about it. I began to count the minutes and hours until he should return. I never knew a night and a day could be so long. But at last his boat arrived at the dock. And a minute later, he came up the path to the lodge.
Hello, Eve.
Oh, how are you, darling? Did you have a nice trip?
A nice trip? Yes, I suppose so.
Philip, is anything wrong?
There's nothing wrong. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm just tired, that's all.
Oh, that's all right, darling. You'll feel better after you've eaten. Here, let me take your coat and the paper.
Thank you.
Well, is there anything in the paper?
No, let me have that paper.
Why, Philip? There's been another murder on the mainland. A woman found slashed to death. Oh, how horrible.
Yes.
Once more, the scalpel killer struck, claiming early this morning a fourth victim. Police would make no statement other than to say that the use of a scalpel by the killer indicates that a doctor...
Must you go on reading that? Isn't it enough that they're dead?
Oh,
I'm sorry, Eve, darling. I heard quite enough about it on the mainland. It was the only topic of discussion.
Yes, I understand. I won't mention it again.
Thank you, Eve. It's good to get away from all that talk. To me, this island represents escape. Escape from the mainland. And all that happens there.
Escape? What was there to hide from? It couldn't be. It couldn't be. And yet, the clippings in his desk. The violent outburst when I'd read the newspaper story. His strange behavior in the past. A picture began to form. A picture I could no longer bear to look at. Weeks passed, and we were as strangers. And then one night, I was awakened by a pair of hands on my throat.
Don't be frightened, Eve. It's nothing.
Why did you put your hands on my throat?
You were tossing in your sleep. I just wanted to see if you had a fever.
No, I'm all right.
Why are you trembling?
I don't know. Philip, what's wrong?
Nothing, Eve, nothing. It's just your imagination.
No, it isn't. Is it anything to do with the murder of those four women?
What makes you ask that?
Is it because of the murder?
No, I tell you, no! You must stop talking about them. Do you hear me?
It's all right, Philip.
I've got to make another trip to Boston. See my publisher.
Another trip to Boston?
Yes. I just have time to catch the morning train.
How long will you be gone?
Just overnight.
Philip, I...
What were you going to say?
Nothing. Here, let me help you pack.
You needn't bother. I'm only taking a few things.
A scalpel.
Why, yes, I thought I'd take your father's instruments to town, have the instruments polished.
Are all the scalpels in your bag?
Yes. Why do you ask?
Well, I just wanted to make sure you hadn't forgotten any. Oh, Philip, why do you look at me that way?
I'm thinking of four women. Four women who were slashed to death.
Philip looked at me for a moment. Then without a word, he left. And suddenly I realized if a murder were committed that night, there would be no escaping the truth. I could do nothing but pray and wait. The day dragged into the night, and at last dawn came. Soon he'd return, and I'd know everything. Everything.
Eve?
Oh, here I am, Philip. How was the trip? Philip, what's happened?
Last night, another woman was murdered on the mainland.
Nothing.
Yes. Her throat was cut, like the others.
Don't tell me anymore. I don't want to hear about it.
Then you know everything.
Yes. I suspected it for months. Only I could never bring myself to believe it.
Eve, there's only one thing left to us.
One thing left to us?
Yes. We must die together, so that innocent people may live in safety.
Philip, what are you saying? I don't want to die.
I know you don't, darling, nor do I, but can't you see it's the only way out? The police are bound to find them. Find them. The murderer. It's just a question of time.
Look, let's not wait and live in fear. We'll go to the police and confess.
No, I couldn't stand to go through all that.
But I don't want to die, and I won't.
Please, Eve, darling, don't make it difficult. You know I can't allow you to live. It's too dangerous.
So that's it. Get rid of me so you can go on living in safety.
You know better than that, Eve. I love you. When you die, I shall follow you.
No! I won't let you kill
me. I've got to, darling. I'll try not to hurt you.
Philip, now you stay where you are. Stay where you are.
I pray this wouldn't be necessary. But last night's murder leaves me no choice. You must die.
You stop following me, Philip. I'm warning you.
What are you getting from under that coat?
Don't move, Philip. If you come any closer, I'll shoot.
After what I've been through, a gun doesn't seem very fair.
I'm warning you, Philip. I'll shoot. I'm not going to die for your crimes.
My crimes?
Yes. You've killed 5 women, but I shan't be the 6th.
You believe I murdered those 5 women?
Well, you've admitted as much.
Eve, darling, put that gun down and listen to me, please. You know the reason your father brought you to this island as a child.
You know I don't. And
I do. And haven't you ever wondered why he practically kept you a prisoner on this island? Educating you himself.
Oh, you're trying to put me off my guard with this talk. Now you stay where you are, Philip.
Among the papers your father left upon his death, I found some which gave a clue as to the reason he retired to this island.
What?
Yes, yes. It all began when you were 10 years old and lived in Boston. Your father found you one night walking through the house in a trance. Oh. Night after night, your father stayed up watching you. Then one night, while in a trance, you strangled your cat to death.
Oh, you're lying.
Think back to when you were 10 years old. Didn't you have a cat? And then one morning it was gone?
Well, it had run away. Father told me
so. He was hiding the truth from you. He destroyed the body. And then a few days later he got you another cat. And it disappeared.
That cat also ran away.
It didn't run away any more than the first one did. You killed it, Eve, in the same manner.
Oh, you're clever, Philip. But I know something of psychology. You can't break me down with such a story and take this gun.
Listen to me. After observing you for some time, your father realized you were a schizophrenic.
Oh.
A female Jekyll and Hyde, a split personality with uncontrollable homicidal tendencies.
You won't break me down, no matter how clever you are.
It was then that your father knew that no one was safe as long as you were free. So he gave up everything he valued and brought you to this island, virtually becoming your jailer.
I'm afraid your story doesn't hold. I was always free to go where I pleased.
Yes, for you weren't dangerous when you were awake. But when you went to sleep each night, didn't your father always see to it that you had a sleeping drug?
No.
Think! Wasn't there some special drink you took before you went to bed?
Oh, only hot milk.
Then that was it. As long as your father lived, he was able to control your sleeping hours. But when he died, the drug was no longer administered. You began to walk at night in a trance.
No.
The first murder occurred exactly a week after your father's death. You were following your subconscious will to kill.
You've never explained where you were the night that first woman was killed.
A month after the first murder, you left this island again. Your father's scalpel in your hand. And another girl was found dead on the mainland. Her throat cut.
I never left this island from the day I returned from my father's funeral.
You never remember having left this island, for when you woke up the following day, you were back in your own room. When I came to this island and told you about the murders, you were naturally shocked. Your conscious mind was not aware of what you had done.
You tell a convincing story, Philip. But you haven't explained why you came to this island with all your baggage just a few hours after a murder had been committed.
That's very
simple.
And
explained the hundreds of clippings you have. And why you tried to strangle me 2 nights ago.
Strangle?
And tell me why you took the scalpels with you yesterday. Oh, no, I know you're the murderer. And I'm going to turn you over to the police.
I've sunk both. You'll never go to the police.
Oh, you're mad. You're completely mad.
I can't allow you to go on living.
Philip, stop coming toward me. I don't want to shoot, but you're forcing me to.
I've got to kill you. I've got
to. Philip, don't, or I'll shoot.
Oh.
Philip! Oh, I didn't want to do it, but you made me. It was either your life or mine. It was true, nothing. You're trying to break me with that story and then murder me as you did the others. But you failed. And I feel so faint, so dizzy. Where When I recovered consciousness, I found myself in my own room. It was just dusk. There was a deathly stillness about the lodge. I got up and went into the living room. Philip's body was on the floor, barely discernible in the dark. Fear welled up in me, and I found myself screaming. I ran out of the lodge and down to the dock. But both boats were sunk, just as he said. My legs gave away, and I sank to the ground. And then I remembered the emergency flares in the boathouse. I thought you'd never arrive, Sheriff. I waited and waited in the darkness, and it seemed as if I were alone in the world, utterly alone.
There, there, ma'am. You're all right now. You gotta get a hold of yourself. It's all over now.
I didn't mean to kill him. I didn't mean to kill him.
Of course you didn't. It was either him or you. You say he was blonde, 6 feet tall. He had a deep scar on his cheek.
Yes, yes.
He once stayed at the Stratford Hotel,
yes.
Huh? I remember seeing him now. I recall he slipped off from the hotel when we started questioning the guests. I wondered about him a couple of times. Guess I should have followed him up. Might have saved the lives of a few innocent women. Oh, come now, ma'am. Crying won't do any good. It's all over now. You're safe. Here, lie down on this couch. Stretch out. Get a little rest. That's it. A couple of hours, it'll be dawn. You'll feel better when you see the sun shining.
You won't leave me, will you?
No, ma'am. I'll stay here with you. While you're getting a little sleep, I'll write out a report of what happened.
I couldn't bear to be alone.
No, you won't be. Close your eyes. Try to get some sleep. That's it. Poor girl. Well, it's all over now. She can sleep in peace.
Wait, I want to...
Number, please.
Agnes, get me Judge Donnelly.
Yes, Sheriff.
Hello?
Judge, Sheriff Mitchell calling.
Sheriff, you called me at 2 a.m. and gave me a full report on the death of the scalpel killer. Now, why are you calling again at 4 a.m.?
Judge.
Yeah, sounds to me like you've been drinking. Now, I reckon the celebration's in order, but why bother me? Now, will you please let me get back to sleep before
I lose... Listen, I haven't much time, Judge.
What's that?
The scalpel killer wasn't Philip Duval.
What are you saying, Sheriff?
He was right.
Right about what?
The girl, Eve.
The girl?
Notify to be on lookout. Brunette, 5'4", gray eyes.
You've had one too many, Sheriff. First you phone and tell me it was Duval. Then you say it's the girl. Now, what proof have you got she's guilty?
There's a scalp on the floor, Judge. And my throat. I'll never live to finish.
And so the curtain falls on the Dark Island, which was chosen by guest expert William Irish, whose latest thriller is The Blue Ribbon. Next week at this time, Murder by Experts brings you a story of a jealous wife and a husband bent on murder, with a most unusual ending, selected for your approval by Alicia Lipscape. Until then, this is your host, John Dixon Carr, hoping you'll be with us next week at this time.
The Dark Island was written by Sidney Morris, adapted for radio by Robert A. Arthur and David Cogan. In the cast were Gertrude Warner, Bernard Grant, and Maurice Tarplin. Music is under the direction of Emerson Buckley, composed by Richard DuPage. Murder by Experts is produced and directed by Robert A. Arthur and David Cogan. This is Phil Tonkin speaking. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
Hi, I'm singer Betty Johnson, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
Big John and Steve, and we are back with you. Hope you enjoyed Murder by Experts. That was called The Dark Island from Monday, August 8th, 1949, originally over Mutual. We have two more shows, including the word murder in the title.
Scary.
Yes.
Murder. I don't want to see no corpse.
Ooh. And we're going to get to those in just a little bit. We have some more birthdays, but we thought we would bring you up to date in the Big John health update information.
It's the Big John health update.
Yeah, that's one I don't have here on the board, Steve.
Mm-hmm.
We'll just have to settle with... Although some of this stuff ain't funny, you know.
Yeah, I don't think your health is funny, but okay.
No, the last time we cut a couple of shows, the last two episodes, you heard me with a little bit higher voice because of raspiness, because of a lot of sinus drainage, which I'm still dealing with, and a bad back, which went out on me just before we started doing the shows. So the pain reliever and the muscle relaxant started to work on me, so... We only got two done in that session. The back is much better. However, I had a mild heart attack a few weeks ago, having shortness of breath, and I thought, well, maybe this is the congestive heart failure acting up, because that's one of the symptoms of it. But I thought, should I go to the ER or should I not? Eventually, I decided I better go, just to keep tabs on this in case it is something more... Well, they decided to do a heart catheter.
Oh, dear.
That's the ER, Steve, not the Eeyore.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes. I could say they nailed my tail back on and everything was fine, but no.
Oh, that would be too much bother.
So they gave me a heart catheter test, and they found that the right carotid artery was
corroded.
Had a big clot.
Ooh.
And was closed down.
Lots of clots.
Yeah, so they replaced that, put a stent in there.
Ooh.
And
tricky stuff.
As far as looking at the heart now, the doc's really satisfied with the way things are looking. So, but if that clot had broken loose, it could have been a lot worse.
Now you only got a heart.
If I only had a brain.
That's what I'm here for.
Because, you know, you knock on my skull, it kind of sounds like this.
Hello.
Yeah, so a little bit of an echo there, as you could tell. But anyway, that was that. Now I've got this breathing situation going on, which kind of feels like a prolonged case of bronchitis.
And you've had that before.
I've had it before.
You've had
but
asthma
not as
before
often,
too.
Not yes. as often, not lasting as long as this has, so...
Mm-hmm. It comes and it goes, yeah.
The end of the month, I have an appointment with a pulmonary expert to find out, hopefully, what's going on there. Because it gets really annoying. You feel like you're really short of breath, and then you take several fast breaths to try to fend off the feeling, because there's a little bit of lightheadedness that comes with that.
Mm-hmm.
So... Yeah, I've had my share of stuff going on with the health.
Nary a Pullman would ever disagree with you, yeah.
This has been a real pain in the Pullman.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a Three Stooges reference for those out there who aren't Three Stooges fans. If you are a Stooges fan, you know what that is.
Mm-hmm.
Paul Payne. What's a heartthrob? A pain in the neck. There we are. So that's basically where we're at. And then I blew out my knee on Monday, a week ago.
Knee, knee, na,
na 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 no no.
I was just walking here in the house and felt something give way very, very painfully.
Suddenly it happened.
Yeah, I sounded like the skipper from Gilligan's Island there.
Nope.
But it's much better now.
Excruciating pain, sudden, in your knee. You're like, ow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I'm walking without crutches now, so hopefully within another week's time, things should be much better.
Then you can tap dance and ta-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
I don't think I'll ever tap dance again, which is not a bad thing because I never did tap dance.
Oh.
Yeah. I'm a heavy guy, so floors tend to suffer. Furniture seems to bounce out of place when I tap dance, so we're just not going to go there.
Just don't flip, stone flop. Boop. Something like that. Yeah, that's right.
All right. Anyway, enough frivolity. What do we got lying here, Steve? We got the next birthday set. You're standing by with that?
I am. Actually, I'm sitting.
Yeah, you're sitting there. Right.
Yes. Let's begin this set with May the 3rd in 1902. Walter Slezak from Vienna, Austria. Yes. He was an actor on Lux Radio Theater, Best Plays, Studio One, and the Columbia Workshop. He was in lots of stuff. Then we have May the 4th in 1930. Gordon Gould was born. Actor on the CBS Radio Mystery Theater and Glowing Dial interviewee.
We
talked with Gordon Gould. I remember
At the same time, we talked with Corrine Orr. They both came down together
as well. Yes. And May the 5th, 1912, Brett Morrison, born in Chicago, Illinois. He was Lamont Cranston on The Shadow. Frank Nelson is May the 6th, 1911, born in Denver, Colorado. Actor, comedian, he was Anthony J. Lyon on Jeff Regan. And he was the nemesis, I guess, on the Jack Benny program. Many times you find him in the store. He was the store clerk that always gave Jack the business.
You really hate me, don't you?
Ooh, do I?
That was him.
Yep.
He was also on many episodes of I Love Lucy and many things. You saw Frank a lot. He was a very, very busy actor. And finishing up the set, May the 7th in 1884, Gloria Gordon was born. She was the mother of actor Gail Gordon.
Mrs. Carmichael.
And she played Mrs. O'Reilly on My Friend Irma.
That's right.
I don't have any friends named Irma, do you, John?
No.
Oh.
But my favorite episode of My Friend Irma was The Ghost.
A ghost?
Every Tuesday night, a ghost in a white sheet is seen in the hallways, and it's got them all really scared, and there's a rather silly ending and explanation to it all, which I'm not telling you. I'm not sure if we featured that episode here on The Glowing Dial before. I think we might have many, many years ago.
Mm.
All right, time for an episode of Murder Clinic. This is called The Tragedy of Marsden Manor, and it's featuring Agatha Christie's detective creation, Mr. Hercule Poirot. It's from Tuesday, October 6, 1942, originally over WOR and Mutual, and it was also heard on the CBC, the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. It stars Maurice Tarplin. Frank Knight is announcing, and the show was sustained. Now, Steve, you've got some information on Murder Clinic.
Yes, I do. An unprecedented treat for any avid detective fiction fan, the series offered a rare opportunity, in the U.S. in any case, to hear one of the most varied compilations of detective fiction ever broadcast, a detective fiction sampler for all intents. To the extent practical, the script adapted from the story selected was adapted from the point of view of the protagonist, which made for a far more compelling and engaging format. Begun in late evening time slot, the better to accommodate the other Mutual network stations across the country, after the first 39 episodes, Mutual attempted to slot the series in the early Sunday evening for New York and its environs. But within a few months, that plan proved problematic for WOR in an apparent negative response to the back-to-back Blood and Guts Fair. It was featuring on Sunday afternoon and evening. WOR changed its schedule to break up its three Sunday afternoon mystery thrillers, Bulldog Drummond, Murder Clinic, and The Shadow, with Musical Fair. That programming decision apparently met with equally mixed reviews, and Murder Clinic eventually left the schedule during the October to November 1943 time frame. A shame, really, given the absolutely excellent productions WOR had been mounting with some of the detective fiction's greatest writers. WOR was approaching its holiday schedule during one of the most tension-filled junctures of World War II. It was apparently a combination of all those factors that resulted in an otherwise excellent production's premature demise. Some notable actors to appear on the show were Alfred Shirley, Maurice Tarplin, Alan Hewitt, oh yes, Ian Martin, and Ted DeCorsia. Some notable authors whose works were featured included Agatha Christie, Earl Stanley Gardner, G.K. Chesterton, John Dixon Carr, and Sax Rohmer. The series aired from July 21st, 1942 to November 7th, oh, my birthday, 1943, over WOR and Mutual, Don Lee.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay!
And more information like that to come with our last program, which we'll be getting to in a little while. But right now, Steve, I think birthdays are out of the way. We've told people about Murder Clinic. It's time to get into the program itself.
Oh. Hey, John, what's this wire thing sticking out of here? On this more...
I wouldn't touch that.
What?
See, that's what happens, Steve.
Ow.
I told you. Sit back, folks, close your eyes, and remember Murder Clinic, the tragedy of Marsden Manor from Tuesday, October 6, 1942, originally over WOR and Mutual.
Murder Clinic, stories of the world's great detectives of fiction. Men against murder. Each week at this time, WOR Mutual turns the spotlight on one of the great figures of crime detection and brings you his most exciting case. Tonight, Agatha Christie's unique detective Hercule Poirot in the tragedy at Marsden Manor. Evening, Monsieur Poirot. I'd recognize you anywhere, I think, thanks to those magnificent mustachios of yours.
Merci bien. They are very magnificent, no?
They are indeed. Tell me, did they help you solve the tragedy at Marsden Manor?
No. It was the little gray cells in the brain of the great Hercule Poirot that prevented this great miscarriage of justice in the death of Richard Maltravers of Marsden Manor. It all began in the little village of Marsden Lee, less than 100 kilometers from London.
Coming! Coming!
Yes, yes, what is it?
Be you Dr. Bernard?
Yes, I am.
Come quick, the master's done for.
You mean Mr. Maltravers of the manor?
Aye, the master. The mistress, she says, fetch the doctor, she says. But it bean't no use. He's a dead un. I knows a dead un when I see un.
What was it, man? An accident?
No, bean't no accident. I found him in the lower meadow, with the blood running out of his mouth. Be a stroke.
A stroke?
That's what it be.
Well, hurry, man, let go. Come now, Mrs. Maltravers. You must get hold of yourself. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. After all, we are all of us mortal.
But why, Richard? He was so good, so kind. Why did this have to happen to him?
Oh, come, please.
He seemed so well, so full of life. Why, only last week he passed a medical examination for insurance. How could he have died so suddenly? Doctor, what happened?
A hemorrhage due to stomach ulcers, undoubtedly, resulting in a stroke.
Mr. Hyde.
Hello, Poirot.
You know my good friend, Captain Hastings, no?
Good morning, Captain Hastings.
Good morning, sir.
Well, Poirot, you got my message, I see.
I did. What is it that disturbs you, mon ami? Richard Maltravers dies, and you send for Poirot. What was the cause of Monsieur Maltravers' death?
The death certificate says a hemorrhage resulting in a stroke due to stomach ulcers.
But surely you did not bring Papa Poirot here to talk of the stomach ulcers. This Richard Maltravers had taken out the insurance policy in your company, no?
And what a policy. For £50,000?
Well, good square sum, that, eh?
Rather.
So, what is it you wish me to do? It is unfortunate for your company, but everything seems, open and above the plank, no?
No, Poirot. Open and above board.
Ah, my good friend, the great Hastings. Always he corrects the English of Hercule Poirot. Monsieur Wright, I ask you, do I not speak the English of a super?
You do indeed. But to get back to your previous question, what my company wishes you to do is to investigate the circumstances of Mr. Maltravers' death.
So, what is it you suspect, mon ami?
Well, of course you know in the case of suicide, the policy is invalid.
Yes.
And when a man past the prime of life takes out an unusually large policy in favor of a young wife half his age and then dies within 2 weeks, the possibility of suicide cannot be ignored.
Of a certainty, mon ami. But suicide by hemorrhage? That is a queer saucepan of fish. Now, if the cause of death had been heart failure, then I would smell a mouse. Heart failure can always mean that a stupid doctor did not find the true cause. But hemorrhage... Ma foi, hemorrhage is, well, hemorrhage.
Exactly. Nevertheless, we are determined to proceed with the matter. You will undertake the inquiry?
But of course. Hastings, that great professor of English, shall go with me. Hey, mon ami?
Gladly, Poirot.
Eh bien, now, where is this place, this Marsden Manor?
You take the Great Eastern Line from Liverpool Station to the little town of Marsden Lee. Marsden Manor is about a mile from the village.
Marsden Lee. All right, Hastings, we go.
This is Marsden Lee, eh? I hope we can get a conveyance up to the manor.
Tickets, sir.
Here you are, my friend.
I suppose you'll be coming down for the funeral, sir.
Funeral? What funeral?
You see, the funeral of Master Maltravers. About the manor.
Oh, you say the manor. Could that be Marsden Manor?
Aye, it be.
That is an odd coincidence. My friend and I, we have come down with a thought of buying this Marsden Manor.
You couldn't pay me to live there, you couldn't.
Why not?
It be haunted.
Haunted?
Aye, haunted. Seen things there, folks says.
Yeah, we should see. Now, could you tell us where a Dr. Bernard lives?
Aye, up yon hill, about half a mile.
Well, come, Hastings. And Dr. Bernard, that you signed the death certificate of a Mr. Richard Maltravers.
Yes, I did.
You understand, Doctor, with such a big policy, we must make the careful investigation.
Of course. I suppose he was such a rich man, his life was insured for a big sum.
You consider him a rich man, Doctor?
Well, was he not? He kept 2 cars, you know, and Marsden Manor is a pretty big place to keep up. Although I believe he bought it very cheaply.
I understand he had considerable losses of late.
Is that so? Indeed. It's fortunate for his widow, then, that there is this insurance.
Yes.
Very beautiful and charming young creature, but terribly unstrung by this sad catastrophe. I've tried to spare her all I could, but of course the shock has been very great.
Why shock? These ulcers of the stomach, they are what you call chronic,
yes.
They are not sudden.
No.
Did you not attend Mr. Maltravers before, Doctor?
My dear sir, I never attended him.
What?
I understand Mr. Maltravers was a member of a faith-healing sect.
But you examined the body?
Certainly. I was fetched by one of the under-gardeners.
And the cause of death was clear?
Absolutely. There was blood on the lips, but most of the bleeding must have been internal.
He had not been moved?
No, the body hadn't been touched. He had evidently been out shooting crows, and a long-barreled bird gun lay beside him. The hemorrhage must have occurred quite suddenly. Gastric ulcers, without a doubt.
He could not have been shot, huh?
My dear sir,
I beg pardon. But I remember once a doctor who said heart failure until the constable showed him a bullet wound through the head.
You will find no bullet wounds on the body or head of Mr. Maltravers. Now, gentlemen, if there's nothing further,
Thank you, Doctor. Just one more thing. You saw no need for the autopsy, huh?
Certainly not. The cause of death was perfectly clear. In my profession, we see no need to distress unduly the relatives of a dead patient. Now, gentlemen, if you'll pardon me, good day.
Well, Hastings, what do you think of our good Dr. Bernard?
Bit of an old fool.
Precisely. Your judgments of character are always profound, mon ami. Except where a young and beautiful woman is concerned. So now you must mind your Q's and P's. Because the good doctor has said that the next one we see is both young and beautiful. This Madame Maltravers. Madame Maltravers, I cannot tell you how I am sorry to bother you in this way.
Must I be bothered now? I know nothing about this insurance of my husband.
Courage, madame. It is necessary. I will do all to make this matter not too unpleasant for you. I, Hercule Poirot, swear it. Now, if you would recount briefly the sad events of last Wednesday, huh?
Well, I was changing for tea when the maid came up. One of the gardeners had just run up to the house. He'd found Richard.
No, I comprehend. Enough. You had seen your husband earlier in the afternoon?
No, not since lunch. I'd walked down to the village for some stamps. I believe he was out pottering around the grounds.
Shooting the crows, no?
So I understand. He usually took his bird gun with him. In fact, I heard one or two shots at a distance.
So? Where is this bird gun now?
Why, in the gun cabinet over there, I suppose.
With your permission, madame. Yeah, here it is. Ah. Two shots fired, I see. And now, madame, a delicate question. Monsieur Maltravers, your husband, is awaiting burial, I believe.
Yes. He's lying in his room.
If I might see?
Why, yes, of course. It's the first room at the top of the stairs. You'll forgive me if I don't go with you.
What, of course. Hastings, you remain here with madame.
Do you think Mr. Poirot will understand why I didn't go with him?
I can assure you, Mrs. Maltravers, Poirot is most sympathetic.
I don't doubt it, Mr. Hastings. I only wish there was more that I could tell him.
Oh, I understand. But I wonder, Mrs. Maltravers, if you could tell me one thing.
Oh, yes?
Well, the station master, an odd character named Volks, said something about Marsden Manor being haunted.
Marsden Manor haunted? Why, surely you're joking, Mr. Hastings.
Oh, no, I assure you. He told us that people have seen things.
We must have been referring to my humble experiments in extrasensory perception. I've always been tremendously intrigued by that subject, and doubtless some of our servants have been gossiping.
Madame, you are mediumistic. How fascinating.
Oh, I wouldn't go so far as to say that, Mr. Poirot. I've dabbled a bit, that's all.
So?
I've managed table levitation and simple things like that. But I suppose to the simple rustics around here, it looks like black magic.
Very interesting. Under kinder circumstances, I would implore a demonstration.
Why, are you interested in such things, Mr. Poirot?
All fields of knowledge interest the great Poirot.
Poirot, don't you think perhaps we'd better...
Oh, I forgot, madame. I thank you for your so great courtesy. I do not think you need be bothered any further by the matter. By the way, do you know anything of your husband's financial position?
Nothing whatever, I'm afraid. I'm very stupid about business.
I see. Then you can give us no clue as to why your husband suddenly decided to insure his life.
Oh, was it sudden? I'm sure I don't know.
Enfin. And now, with your permission, madame, we will go. Hastings?
Oh, I'll see you to the door.
Merci. Oh, just one more thing, madame. Could you tell me, when they found Mr. Maltravers, did they find him unshod, without the shoes?
Why, really, Mr. Poirot, I don't understand.
It is nothing. It does not matter. And now, madame, adieu. Oh, but look, you have another visitor. Someone is coming up to walk, huh?
Archie!
Hello,
you!
Emily.
Why, I thought you were on your way back to Australia.
Yes, I was. But I read the news of Uncle's death in Paris and hurried back. Emily, my dear, is there anything I can do for you? Anything?
Oh, of course not. What could you do? Oh, I'm sorry, I'm forgetting. Mr. Poirot, this is Captain Black, my husband's nephew. Captain Black, Mr. Hastings.
How down? Emily, how did this happen? Uncle seemed perfectly well when I was here Monday night.
You've evidently read the papers, Archie. You must know what happened.
But they gave no details, just the bare notice of his death. What happened?
Archie, I just can't go through all that again.
Yes, Captain Black, I'm afraid my friend and I, we have disturbed madame.
What are you doing here?
I am Hercule Poirot, the Hercule Poirot.
Mr. Poirot is from the insurance company, Archie.
That's just why I've come back. To protect you from annoyances like this.
You shouldn't have risked your job, Archie. If you left right away, you might still get to Paris in time to make your boat train.
You say Paris, mon capitaine. You go to Australia by way of Paris?
Why, yes. I intended taking the Orient Express from there and pick up the Pacific Mail at Port Said.
Ah, oui. That shortens the journey, does it not? You are staying here, Captain Black?
Yes, I'm staying at the Pig and Thistle. That's the inn down in the village.
Aye, village inn. It serves the roast beef, no?
Why, yes, I suppose so.
Good. So, Hastings, let us try this roast beef at the Pig and Thistle, huh?
All right, Poirot. Now you've had your roast beef. Hadn't we better be getting back to London?
No, not so fast, my good Hastings. London, she will not run away. But this Captain Black, he may do so. A garçon, garçon.
For heaven's sake, Poirot. English inns don't have garçons.
No? Then who is it who approaches?
What do you have, Governor?
For my friend, the dictionary. For me, a buck.
He means beer, George.
I mean the ale.
Righto, Governor. You've been up at the manor, sir?
I mean, yes, we have.
It's sad business, that. I knew no good had come of it as soon as they took the manor.
You mean this, Maltravers? They were not popular?
Well, not that, Governor. He was a bit too old for her, if you know what I mean.
Awesome.
She might better have married the nephew. Leastways, I'll bet a bob the nephew thought so.
Ah, there has been the gossip, huh?
Oh, I wouldn't go so far as that, Governor. But he did hang around a bit.
And the husband, Mr. Maltravers? He object?
Not as I knows of, Governor. But why is my opinion, I is.
Without the doubt, it is the worst opinion, non, George? But, the Captain Black, here he comes now.
Hello, Poirot, here you are.
Captain Black, come, will you not join us? Bock, perhaps?
Yes, thanks, I don't mind if I do. Waiter, a mug of ale.
Right, hello, Governor.
Sad business, this death of your uncle, eh?
Yes, and so sudden, too. He seemed in excellent health when I dined with him Monday night.
So? And was he also in good spirits? What did he say? Of what was the talk at this dinner Monday night?
Oh, I don't know. The usual general topics.
I see.
My uncle asked about my people. We talked of Australia.
Yes.
Then Mrs. Maltravers asked a lot of questions about East Africa, where I've spent some time. I told them one or two yarns. That's about all, I think.
Madame Maltravers seems much upset at the death of her husband, no?
Naturally. They'd been married less than a year.
So I hear. A remarkable woman, this lady.
Remarkable in what way? What do you mean?
She has, the seeing eye. I hear her tell Hastings. She does the seance. He seems most interested, no, Hastings?
Oh, I wouldn't go so far as that.
Always the conservative, Hastings. Me, I am not so.
Why, Mr. Poirot, don't tell me you believe in this psychic stuff.
Oh, I have not the closed mind. For example, Captain Black, you have told us all that your conscious self knows. Now, with your permission, I would question your subconscious, huh?
Psychoanalysis, eh? Well, it's nonsense, but I don't mind.
Merci. It is like this. I give you a word. You answer with another word. Any word, the first word you think of. Eh bien, shall we begin?
Go ahead.
Hastings, note down the words, please.
Well, very well, Colonel.
Now, day.
Night.
Name.
Place.
Bernard.
Shore.
Monday.
Dinner.
Journey.
Ship.
Country.
Uganda.
Story.
Lions.
Bird gun.
Farm.
Shot.
Suicide.
Elephant.
Tusks.
Money.
Lawyers.
So, that is all. You are a good subject, mon capitaine.
You don't mean to tell me that rigmarole means anything to you?
Maybe not. But nevertheless, you are a good subject.
Well, if you don't need me anymore, I think I'll go upstairs and unpack. Shall I see you again before you leave, Mr. Poirot?
Yes, I should not be surprised.
Good. See you later.
Au revoir, mon capitaine. And now, my clever Hastings, you see it all, no?
Well, I don't know what you mean, Poirot.
Does that list of words tell you nothing?
Sorry, I'm afraid it doesn't.
Then I will assist you. To begin with, the captain answered within the time limit. No pauses, no making up the mind.
Yeah.
Day to night and place to name are normal associations. Then I give him Bernard, the name of the doctor, if he knew him.
Oh.
Evidently he does not. When I say Bernard, he says sure. Monday means dinner, country is Uganda. Story recalls the lion story he tells them. All natural. But now, notice. When I mention bird gun, I get the unexpected answer, farm. When I say shot, he answers at once, suicide. A man he knows commits suicide with a bird gun on a farm somewhere. Imbecile that I am! The great Hercule Poirot is hoodwinked.
What are you talking about?
Do you not see, Hastings? That is the story the Captain Black told at the dinner Monday night.
Oh, I see. And you think that gave Maltravers the idea? You think he shot himself in the mouth with that bird gun?
Why not? Remember, the bird gun has a very tiny charge of powder. The bullet would remain lodged in the brain. All that would show would be the blood in the mouth. Come, Hastings. It is not too late.
Of course, but where?
To see once more this dead man, to Marsden Manor. Hastings,
to Marsden Manor.
Alas, Mrs. Maltravers, it is true. Your husband shot himself through the mouth with the bird gun.
You mean suicide?
It would seem so, madame.
But the insurance?
Naturally, madame, the suicide will void the policy. It is unfortunate, but what will you?
Oh, but this is impossible. My husband would never commit suicide. It's inconceivable.
What the evidence, madame? It is conclusive.
No. There must be some other explanation.
You mean murder, madame? Well, of course, that is always possible. But no, not likely, I'm afraid.
But you do admit it's possible. You just said it was possible.
Yes, of course, everything is possible. Have you any idea who might have wished to kill your husband?
Why, no. No, I haven't.
Madame, I have a suggestion. It is bizarre, no doubt, but perhaps if you are willing to help.
Oh, yes, yes, of course, anything.
Madame, you are mediumistic. Perhaps if you would try...
Perhaps you're right. Perhaps I could get through to Richard. He might tell us what happened.
I am sure you could do it, madame.
Yes, yes, I'll do it. Come back here tonight at 8 and bring Captain Black with you.
Eh bien, madame, I am sure you will succeed. Until 8, madame, au revoir.
Hello? You were the ethical agency? Oh, we do well. This is Hercule Poirot. Dear mon ami, Henri, I have a part for you. For one appearance only. Oui, oui, as always. Now listen closely. This is what I wish you to do.
Mm-hmm.
news. Et dit, bien, merci. Hello, Scotland Yard. Inspector Japp, please. Hello, Japp. This is Poirot. Quite well, thank you. Inspector, I think I have a murderer for you. No, there is no time to explain. Be at Marsden Manor, Marsden Lee, at 8 o'clock tonight. Wait outside the window. And do not come in until I call, eh? Good, remember. Marsden Manor at 8.
Madame Atrovers, we are on time, as you see. Hastings and I have brought Captain Black with us.
I say, there's a bad storm coming up. Would that interfere with the experiment?
Certainly not, Mr. Hastings. This isn't mumbo jumbo. The weather has nothing to do with it.
Well, let us proceed, huh?
Yes. Now, will you draw chairs up around this table, please? Now, Mr. Hastings, if you'll put out the light.
Certainly.
Now, remain perfectly quiet, please, no matter what you hear or see. Richard. Richard. Can you hear me, Richard? Can you hear me? If you can, rap. Rap 3 times. Did you hear that?
Ah, but of course, madame. Did you not tell him to rap 3 times?
That's how Richard always used to knock.
Perhaps he is outside.
No.
They say the suicide never rests, always returns.
Listen. What was that?
The front door slammed.
What? No, Captain Black. It was but the thunder.
Listen. Poirot, I hear footsteps.
It is the wind, madame. I will close the door. I have locked it.
Don't do that. If it should open now.
By Jove, it is open.
He's there. There in the doorway.
I see nothing, madame.
I saw him, I tell you. My husband, you must have seen him too.
Look. She's right. He is there. His hand. Look, it's pointing. What's that light coming from?
It's pointing at her.
Mon Dieu. Her hand. Her right hand. It is scarlet with blood.
Blood? Yes, it's blood. I killed him. I did it. Take him away. Take him away.
Lights.
Good heavens, Poirot, she's got away through that window.
Do not worry, mon capitaine. The good Inspector Japp outside will stop her.
Good heavens, that lovely creature, a murderer.
And a very clever one, my susceptible Hastings. After all, she could not know she would come up against the great Hercule Poirot. And she might even have fooled me if she had only taken off his shoe.
His shoe, Poirot?
Only with his toe. Could he himself have pulled the trigger of this bird gun? And parbleu, his shoes were still on when they found him.
But I don't understand. This seance, was it all fake?
Mais certainement. She meant to pull the sheep.
Wool.
Very well, wool. But it was I who pulled the sheep's wool over her eyes. Thanks to my good friend Henri Dubois, who played the part of the husband's ghost, and Papa Poirot, who put the red paint on her hand in the dark.
But what was her idea in having this seance?
Parbleu, mon capitaine, do you not see? Madame, she will go into the trance. She will hear the voice. She will come out from the trance. She will, with great reluctance, name the murderer.
You mean she meant to confess?
Mais non, mon capitaine. She meant to name you.
You have been listening to Murder Clinic.
Murder Clinic, the WOR Mutual series which brings to you each week one exciting case. Tonight, the tragedy of Marsden Manor with Agatha Christie's unique detective Hercule Poirot, played by Maurice Tarplin. Next week, Murder Clinic will bring you Fred Irving Anderson's Deputy Farr, the Vermont farmer who became chief of the Homicide Bureau in New York City. Deputy Parr, the man with the nose for murder. The story is Gulfstream Green, in which the deputy proves that the conceit of murderers is colossal. Original music was composed by Ralph Barnhart and conducted by Bob Stanley. This program was an international exchange feature over the coast-to-coast network of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. Tales told on Murder Clinic are adaptations by authors Lee Wright and John A. Bassett. Murder Clinic is produced under the direction of Alvin Flanagan. Frank Knight speaking. This is Mutual.
Hi, this is Bob Hastings. Just telling you that you should be listening to Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve. Don't miss it. It's fun.
It's Big John and Steve, and we are back with you once again here on the Glowing Dial, in which Steve and I scream out, "It's murder!" Or we try to scream out. Anyway, that was Murder Clinic we just heard, The Tragedy of Marsden Manor. That was featuring Agatha Christie's creation, Mr. Hercule Poirot. Investigator.
Belgian. Yeah, he's a Belgian.
Par excellence.
Not
yes.
French. Belgian.
A Belgian.
Belgian, yeah, not French.
I was thinking French. All right.
It sounds French, but it's not. Surprise, surprise.
Surprise, surprise. What I don't know can fool me. That was from Tuesday, October 6, 1942, over WOR in Mutual, and also was heard in Canada on the CBC.
Ooh.
So we have one more Moida program to bring you. We're going to get to that shortly. But giving you some more personal information on ourselves, Steve, you've had a few fascinating things happen to you, haven't you?
Today? I went and had an oil change done this morning. That's part of routine auto maintenance. I get a cheering for having my oil done? Well, it's about time. I'm a little overdue. My wife.
I think the applause was just a little bit of satire there, Steve. It's just, you know.
Oh, wise guy, eh?
Certainly.
And then I had to stop at the UPS store and return some merchandise that my wife ordered from Home Shopping Network that she couldn't fit into or didn't fit right or something was wrong, so she had to send it back.
I bet you a lot of that stuff gets sent back.
Sometimes, yes. That's the only problem with ordering things online. Never order shoes online.
I like to try them on.
You can't try them on. How can you? It's like impossible to get a perfect fit or whatever. So never do that. So there'll always be some kind of stores that you visit. You
know, these days. That's true.
I had to stop at the bank and get some money so we have some money in the house for, you know, unexpected things pop up or whatever. So I had to do that this morning. And then I came to see you.
Money in the House. Sounds like a British sitcom, doesn't it?
Money in the House?
Sequel to Doctor in the House or something.
I don't know. Money in the House. Oh, yeah.
Actually, Doctor in the House had many sequels. Essentially the same show with many name and locale changes.
You know, like when the paper boy comes to the door, knock, 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 I'm not delivering your paper, you need to pay me. Oh, here's some money in the house for you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Or, I don't feel like cooking today, let's go get something. We can't, we have no money in the house.
Well, yeah, okay. But I was going to tell you as well, though, you touched that wire just before the last show came.
It doesn't belong there, stupid thing.
But you shouldn't touch a wire when the McGee machine is working to tune in a broadcast because it could short circuit and you could end up being the radio, kind of like Gilligan was on that one Gilligan's Island.
Oh, when he opened his mouth, the music would come out.
Yeah.
Mm, so I don't necessarily believe that, but...
Celebrity birthdays. On May the 8th, 1899, Mr. Arthur Q. Bryan was born in Brooklyn, New York. He's an actor. He was George Doc Gamble on Fibber, McGee, and Molly. and he was the voice of Elmer Fudd in the Warner Brothers cartoons.
Ooh.
Think Mel Blanc did it all? No, he didn't. May the 9th, 1898, Edith Meiser from Detroit, Michigan. She was a writer on the life and love of Dr. Susan, The Shadow, and Sherlock Holmes. May the 10th, 1911, Tony LaFranco from New York City, announcer on Family Theater, and Johnny Madero, Pier 23. May the 11th, 1899, Forrest Lewis came into this world in Knightstown, Indiana. He was an actor. He was Richard Q. Peavy in The Great Gildersleeve, Roy Delfino in Vic and Sade. Well, now, I wouldn't say that. May 12, 1907, Leslie Charteris, born in Singapore. He was a mystery writer, and he wrote The Adventures of the Saint. And then, of course, there was The Return of the Saint, which was kind of a sequel series, which starred Ian Ogilvy. The original starred Roger Moore, both on TV. Of course, they were done on the radio with Vincent Price. And lastly, May 13th, 1909, Ken Darby from Hebron, Nebraska. Singer, choral conductor for the Kingsmen on Fibber McGee and Molly. And that does it for the celebrity birthdays this time around. Tune into the next episode of The Glowing Dial for more of the same. Now we have an episode of Murder Will Out for you. It's The Mystery of Death Undersea. From Sunday, July 8th, 1945, over ABC, starring William Gargan and Edward Marr. Larry Keating is announcing, and the sponsor is Rainier Beer. Now, Steve has, looks like, a good bit of information on
Larry
Murder
Keating.
Will Out.
I just saw Larry Keating this morning. He's the guy that was on Mr. Ed.
Yes, Addison, the neighbor.
Yes, Larry Keating. Yeah, he was on an episode of, what did I see him on this morning? He was with B. Benaderet, and they were on... Oh, it was a George Birds and Allen show.
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah, they were on that one. Yeah. But we're talking about Murder Will Out. I must read this. Murder Will Out followed the Ellery Queen formula to a point. Each show contained a fully dramatized mystery, followed by guesses from the audience as to the killer's identity. Unlike Queen, this contained no trick clues, the stories unfolding in chronological order, with the clues considered in the order found. Listeners were thus on the same plane as the police and the contestants. The series was framed in the San Francisco Bay Area with Edmund MacDonald starring as Inspector Burke, chief of the SFPD Homicide Division, and aided by local favorite Eddie Marr as Inspector Burke's sidekick, Detective Nolan. MacDonald remained in the role throughout the 39th episode, at which point seasoned film, radio, and television character actor William Gargan was brought in as Inspector Burke. Gargan retained the role throughout the last installment. Four contestants, two of each sex, were drawn from the audience. Awards of $5 in war stamps were given for each correct answer. Winners who guessed the killer and the correct clue won a $50 war bond. That was a lot of money back in those days, yeah. And a gold detective certificate framed for display. Each contestant had been given a script and a pen to take notes during the dramatic presentation. Each contestant in turn was then asked a series of questions. Ed Donald or William Gargan were then handed the papers upon which each contestant had annotated their deductions for both the murderer and correct key clue for the evening. MacDonald or Gargan would then read the results to each contestant's recorded deductions, announcing any respective awards for each contestant's submissions. MacDonald or Gargan would then recite the correct clue or clues that led to the actual murderer in the evening's mystery. Inspector Burke would then thoroughly synopsize the entire mystery, citing the trails of clues and the character development points for each potential suspect. The respective winners were then announced, summarizing their winnings for the evening. MacDonald or Gargan would then synopsize and announce the title of the following week's murder mystery. The series announcer and commercial spokesperson was the soon-to-be highly popular Larry Keating, later to become a comedy fixture in film, radio, and television. Keating is most remembered for his television roles as next-door neighbor Harry Morton in the George Burns and Gracie Allen Show, which I mentioned earlier, and in Mr. Ed as Roger Addison, Alan Young's long-suffering neighbor. Keating's sudden death from leukemia in 1963 almost shut Mr. Ed down. The Rainier Brewing Company of San Francisco and Los Angeles sponsored Murder Will Out from start to finish, one of the better-supported regional programs of the era. Rainier Brewing provided all the financial support necessary to ensure the highest production values throughout the series' run. Murder Will Out was an entertaining concept, very cleverly, smartly, and satisfactorily executed. The byplay between the contestants and Larry Keating was as entertaining as the murderer mysteries. The murder mysteries themselves took great pains to provide a rational and entirely supportable trail of clues to the actual murderer in each dramatization. Writer Lou Lansworth kept the mysteries interesting and challenging, with no 11th-hour revelations to throw a monkey wrench into either the contestants' or the audience's logical deduction processes. No mean feat in itself. The series also affords us an advanced glimpse at the natural comedic talent and acerbic charm of Larry Keating prior to his extraordinary success in television. All told, Murder Will Out had something for everyone. The series only aired on the West Coast via KGO San Francisco and ABC, so it's a shame that a national audience never had the opportunity to hear the series. The series was heard on Tuesday evenings.
Thank you, Steve, for all that information there.
Naturally.
You mentioned KGO San Francisco. Mm-hmm. That's where Jack Webb got a lot of his radio work started.
Oh, yes. Dragnet mm-hmm. and, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. Is Johnny Madero. He did Pat Novak for Hire.
A whole web of those kind of shows.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And now if you want to look him up on the internet, go to his website.
W-E-B-B web.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Not many of those per show, but, you know, we try to give you what we can. Anyway, now that information is out, it's time to get this program underway.
Mm.
So, Steve, take your place at the McGee machine and don't touch that wire.
I'm not going to. We're going to unplug it, and I'm going to put that wire back in its place after it's unplugged.
After the show, right?
That's right. Here we go. How are we getting anything?
There we go. All right, folks, so sit back, close your eyes, and remember, Murder Will Out. This is The Mystery of Death Under Sea from Sunday, July 8th, 1945, originally over ABC and KGO.
Though it hath no tongue, murder will out. Rainier Brewing Company, brewers of Rainier Beer and Ale, presents Murder Will Out. Starring William Gargan as Inspector Burke, Chief of Homicide, with Eddie Marr as Detective Nolan, in another challenging story written and directed by Lou X. Lansworth, The Mystery of Death Under Sea.
On the night of Monday, April the 22nd, a thick, vaporous mist blanketed the entire city. In the black waters of the bay, a diving barge was tied to a north end dock. Aboard the barge was the owner, Captain Al Charles, veteran deep-sea diver. Guided by a dark lantern, the captain was busy checking equipment. Shortly before 8 p.m., careful footsteps descended the ladder leading to the fog-enveloped barge.
Captain. Captain Charles.
Yes?
Where are you, Captain?
What is it?
Can't see in this fog.
Just a minute. Who are you?
I come to talk business.
What do you want?
Got a message for you from a friend.
Yeah?
You alone, Captain?
What is it you want?
His friend to make it worth your while. Pay you a lot of money.
What's this all about?
This friend don't want you to do their job tomorrow morning.
What job?
The body the cops are looking for.
Oh?
The body the cops think was tossed in the water. If you're smart, Captain, collect a double price.
How?
Well, the cops hire you and your crew to do a diving job. Okay, so you do the job, but you don't find no body. Now, the cops pay off, and this friend, he also pay off. $5,000 cash.
Beat it.
Lots of money, Captain, just to take a gander at the seaweed.
I said beat it.
Stay right there, Captain.
What?
This gun will go off when that foghorn blows. Nobody ever hear it.
I'll have the cops after you so fast.
Hold it. If you change your mind, Captain, and want to do business...
I'm not changing my mind, and I don't...
Okay. Before I go, just a friendly tip. If you do happen to bring up that body tomorrow, Captain, the cops will be dragging the bay for two bodies instead of one.
So starts The Mystery of Death Undersea, another Inspector Burke mystery drama brought to you by Rainier Brewing Company. After the mystery, four contestants chosen from our studio audience as amateur detectives will compete for prizes. They'll be asked a number of questions regarding police findings and who they think committed the crime and the one clue that reveals the criminal. But first, here's Larry Keating. Larry, I wonder if that gangster will make good his threat. You know, this promises to be one of our most exciting mysteries.
Well, you can count on plenty of excitement, Reed, if they tangle with Inspector Burke. That's one thing you can be sure of.
Almost as sure as you are of Rainier, eh, Larry?
Yes, Reed, and thank you. Because I'm sure of this about Rainier. Every pound of malt that goes into the making of Rainier beer is made in Rainier's own malt house. Every pound of hops that flavors Rainier beer is harvested from the deep, cool canyons of Rainier's own hop ranches. No wonder I'm so sure of Rainier. So sure of Rainier quality. And you'll be too, once you've tasted its mellow goodness. Yes, Rainier malt, Rainier hops, Rainier skill, Rainier tradition. They all add up to the best glass of beer you can buy.
The best glass of beer because it's made best to taste best.
Yes, made best to taste best. It's Rainier for quality, for flavor, for good cheer.
Now, back to our story, The Mystery of Death Undersea, starring William Gargan as Inspector Burke.
Ed. Ed, how are you?
Frank, where are you?
Here, over here, Ed. See the captain?
Yeah, it looks okay.
You mean he go for the deal?
No, I mean he's gonna tell the cops.
It's good. You did okay, Ed. Now the captain, he walk into our little trap.
Yeah, if he don't wait for his boy Chris to come aboard.
Oh, Myra, she'll take care of the captain's board. Myra and the boy dancing at the Purple Parrot. She keep Chris out of late.
We're taking a big chance, Frank, heisting the captain.
We take even a bigger chance of the cops fish out the body.
Yeah, but what if they bring
What's the matter? Lose your nerve?
No.
Okay, then how many times I tell you? Cops find that body, it's a curtain for you and me, Ed.
Hey, wait. Listen.
Mm. You're no wasting no time. Get back at this lumber.
It's him, all right. Coming up that ladder.
Okay, no slip up. I flash the light, make sure. Get him in back. Use the butt of your gun.
Okay.
Excuse me, mister.
Who are you?
I'm looking for Peter Hitch. I thought maybe...
What are you doing on this dock?
I'm lost. Maybe you can tell me how... Ed, come on. We'll take him into the car, the hideout. She's a smart girl, at Myra. Catch on fast, eh, Chris?
What's the idea for only getting rid of Myra?
Your girlfriend don't mind wait, Chris. Myra is sitting in the lounge while you and me have a little talk.
What is it you want, Peroni?
Chris, how do you like to have $5,000 cash?
But $5,000?
Yeah, got a little business proposition.
What is it?
Tomorrow, that job you and your father do for the cops. Don't come up with a nobody.
Oh, you're crazy. My father's been doing diving jobs for the cops for 30 years.
Your father, he don't have to know.
What about the cops? The cops want that body.
I take care of that. I fix it so there won't be nobody.
Oh, how?
Lots of times when you do a diving job, get down after wrecks and things like that, you have to do a little blasting.
Yeah?
Okay, I got an expert do a little job. Tomorrow morning, in the pocket of your diving suit, you'll find a small time bomb.
Go on.
You'll go down, find the body, plant the time bomb. Then there'd be no more body.
Yeah?
You like to read this newspaper, Chris? Yeah, when you get home, take a look at the sports page.
Oh, thanks. See how the SEALs do yesterday.
Oh, they do okay. But you do even better, Chris. Inside the sports page, you find an envelope. $1,000. $1,000 bills.
Well, thanks, Veroni.
$4,000 more tomorrow and you do the job.
Yeah, but there's only one hitch, bro.
Oh?
My father's going to do the dive with me.
Your father won't be around, Chris.
What do you mean?
You'll do the job alone.
Where is he? What happened to my father?
No, wait. You...
Come on, where is he? What did you do with him?
Chris, you're going off your nut. People, look. Let's go.
Okay, but let's stand. Talk and talk fast, or I'll shove your face in.
Okay, now you listen to me. Your father's going away. If you don't do that job, your father, he don't come back.
Yeah, I get it now. This whole thing's nothing but a frame-up. That Myra, she's in on it, too. That's why she's been playing up to me. That's why she left us alone just now.
Your newspaper, Chris. You dropped your newspaper.
Well, kind of looks like you got me in a squeeze, Piperoni. I don't have no choice, do I?
That's right, Chris. You don't have no choice.
All right, Sergeant, pull up alongside.
Okay, Inspector. Cut the engine, Mac. Hold it with the hook, Inspector. Got it?
Yes.
There, I got the ladder, Chief.
All right. We'll go back on board the barge, Nolan.
Right. Swing up after you, Chief.
Make it all right, Inspector.
Yes, Jack. Where's Chris?
He's over there. He's already in his diving suit.
Nolan, wait here a second with Jack.
Okay.
Well, Chris, all set to go underwater?
Yeah.
I went aboard the police boat.
Yeah?
I talked to headquarters on the two-way radio.
Oh?
I gave them a complete description of your father. They're sending out a tracer.
Okay.
I've known your father a long time, Chris. He's a friend of mine. Anything you can tell me about his disappearance?
No, nothing.
Well, there's two things we're going to do, Chris. Find that body and find your father. Oh, Jack. Jack Boyle. Nolan.
Yeah, Chief.
Yeah, Inspector. What is it, Inspector?
Jack, in the absence of the captain, you're in charge of the crew?
Yes, sir.
You're certain this is the spot where we go underwater?
Oh, yeah, positive. Yesterday, Captain Charles and Chris took position.
What are we waiting for, Inspector? This is the spot, all right?
Yeah, we better get going. I checked the tide, speed of the current.
Your men assigned to their positions?
Yeah, LaFarge and Anderson handle the pump, Jameson and Brown on the lifelines. I'll take
Nolan, the... Nolan, you take the phone.
Okay, Chief.
Yeah, well, I was gonna
We're all set, then. All right? Where's the captain's diving suit?
What... What do you mean?
I'm going down with you, Chris.
Going down? Well, you can't go down, Inspector. It's too
dangerous. Why not? I've gone underwater a number of times before with Captain Charles.
Why, sure. A couple of years back when the Lorelei sank with all hands, the inspector went down that time with the captain.
Now, get me into that diving suit. That is, if Chris doesn't mind.
Well, no, I don't mind.
Lifelines ready, Leo.
Well, Chris is all set, Chief. Ready to get down.
All right. I'll follow him down.
Are you ready, Inspector?
All ready.
The sounding at this spot is 96 feet.
Pretty deep, Chief.
You and Chris stay underwater no longer than 30 minutes. 30 minutes from the time you break surface. Till we bring you up.
What are we waiting for?
Yeah, okay. Brad, Frenchie, pump's okay.
Okay, Jack.
All right. I'll give Chris the signal. Drop the weighted spike overboard. Chris will follow the line down. He'll sink the spike at the bottom. You two take the rope, fan out from the spike. You're all set, Chris!
Hey, wave his hand.
Okay, Inspector. Get on the ladder, ready to follow him down. Paul! Leo! Get the inspector's helmet on.
Right.
Well, good luck, Chief.
Stay with those phones, Nolan.
Oh, you bet.
Here's your helmet, Inspector. We'll get it on. Got it, Leo?
Yeah, there it is.
No. 1/8 of a turn. Lock it.
Ready?
All set.
Drop the spike. Now let out the line. Send Chris down. All right, second line. Send the inspector down. Red, pressure okay.
Okay.
Paul, lifeline's okay.
All clear. Approximate depth, 96 feet. Waiting their signal.
Well, everything seems to be in order, Nolan.
Good. I'm all set with the earphones, listening device.
You fellas got a lot of police boats out today. 3 of them.
That's right. We're going to keep them there, too. Patrol around the barge.
Not taking any chances,
no,
huh?
Sir. We thought... Wait a minute. There's the signal.
Jack, they're at the bottom. 2 tucks and Chris. Call for more lines.
Nolan, we're at bedrock. Chris is sinking the spike. But pretty heavy. We'll take the rope and fan out from the spike. I'll follow Chris and work with the light. Nolan. Nolan.
Go ahead, Chief.
Looks like we're going around in circles. Fanned out with the rope. We're out about 50 feet from the spike. Current slow. Mud almost up to our waist. No trace of the body.
Hold the light. Straight ahead, Inspector. Now, to the left. To the right.
See anything, Chris?
No. Give me the light, Inspector. You stay here. Hold the rope. I'm going to drop down there. Investigate that hollow.
Nolan. Nolan. Can you hear me? Nolan. Something wrong with the...
Jack. Proof. The inspector's lifeline. Phone went dead.
Leo, check that line.
Nolan. Nolan.
Wait. It's Chris. Chris.
Nolan. I've located the body. Down in this hollow. Body's weighted. Arms and feet tied. Anchored with heavy window weights.
Chris, you get down to the inspector. Something went wrong with the lifeline. Phone went dead.
Okay. I'll get out of this hollow. Don't hoist on the line till I investigate.
That's Chris. He found the body. He's going after the inspector.
Get the rig back.
Wait a minute. Stand by. Hold your positions. Chris. What's taking him so long? Chris. Okay, start hoisting the lifeline. We can't take any chance.
Deck crew, don't hoist the lifeline. Cut the air pressure till I see if the release valves are okay.
Chris, what is it? What's happened?
The grappling hooks, that heavy line, weighted tools you sent down, tangled with the inspector's lifeline. Air hose, hoist me up about 20 feet. I can untangle it.
Yes, put the body over there, Red.
Well, Chief, how does it feel to be back on deck again?
Fresh air certainly feels good. Down there, it felt like my head was going to explode. I kept seeing some big black shadow floating towards me, then going away again.
That's probably me, Inspector.
Well, now that we've got the body, what next, Chief?
We'll go ashore, find out what happened to Chris's father, Captain Charles.
Chief, I just picked up Frank Ferroni. Holding him outside.
Good. What about Ed David?
No trace of him yet. Say, what do you think? Ferroni was picked up for speeding just out of town.
Looks like he might have been tipped off. Got wind, we found the body.
Oh, there's one thing I wanted to ask you, Chief. A tangled lifeline. You think it might have been done on purpose?
By whom?
Chris, Jack Boyle.
Well, Chris untangled the line, found the body.
Yeah. Well, is there any word from Chris?
No, after we got ashore, Chris and Jack Boyle left together. Bring Frank Ferroni in here, Nolan, and see what he has to say.
Okay.
All right, Moroni, in the inspector's office.
Well, Inspector, looks like the rest of the speeding pretty serious, huh? Bring it down to homicide.
Yes, especially when the speeder is wanted for murder.
And kidnapping.
What do you mean?
Moroni, we found the body of that full-time mobster you and Ed Davis bumped off. That clinches the evidence against both of you.
Send you both to the gas chamber.
Where's Captain Charles?
Captain Charles?
Yeah, what did you do with him?
Just a minute. Hello? Yes? Well, send him right in. Open the door, Nolan.
Right, Chief. Well, look who's here.
Hello, Nolan.
Help. Captain Charles.
Hello, Inspector. Oh, I see you got him all right. He's one of them. One of the men who kidnapped me.
Where's the other one, Captain? Ed Davis.
He held me prisoner in a cabin just out of town. I finally got my chance, then I slugged him and got away.
How long ago?
About 45 minutes ago. I ran out on the highway, hitched a ride all the way to headquarters. No phones out that way.
Well, that's fine, Captain. But what about
Don't
the other...
Don't worry. That fellow never get away. He's out there waiting for you.
What do you mean?
I got him tied up with a rope, hand and foot. This is it, Inspector. This is the cabin.
Hey, Chief, listen. Somebody's in there.
Yeah, sounds like a fight. Come on, bring Peroni with you, Nolan.
Chris,
you're
choking me.
Inspector, it's Chris, Jack Boyle.
All right, break it up. Captain, grab Chris. I'll get Jack. Come on, break it up. Stand back there. Now, both of you, cut off the fighting. Quiet down.
Hey, Chief.
What is it, Nolan?
Over here.
Well, Ted Davis.
Yeah, tied with that rope, all right. And look at this.
Yes, a noose tightly drawn around his neck. Strangled to death.
Yeah, body right under that rafter up above.
Uh-huh. This rope around his neck about 3 feet long. Cut clean as a whistle.
Oh, here's the rest of the rope, Chief. Look, both ends match.
Yes. Oh, Captain, is this the way you left Ed Davis?
No. No, I tied Davis up all right, but I didn't put that noose around his neck. He was alive, tied up on the floor when I left.
He did it, Inspector. There's your man, Jack Boyle.
He's lying. Chris was already here when I got here.
Well, I trailed Jack here to my car. When I entered, he was standing near the body. I took him by surprise.
Don't let him tell you that. I was the one who trailed Chris. He was hiding outside when I found the body, hanging up there.
Where?
From that rafter up there. The body was hanging at least 3 feet from the ground. I cut it down. Then I untied the rest of the rope from the rafter. Just then, Chris rushed in. When he saw I spoiled his plan, he tried to kill me, too.
Well, you dirty, rotten liar.
Hold it. Quiet down.
Okay. Okay, but I got a piece of evidence, Inspector, that proves Jack was working for Peroni.
What's that?
This morning, when you went aboard that police boat, there was a small time bomb planted in the pocket of my diving suit. I took the bomb apart so there'd be no danger. It's locked up in our quarters on the barge.
Well, what about this, Peroni?
I don't know nothing. I wasn't here.
Is this the place you were speeding away from, Peroni?
No.
Yes. Did you hang Davis from that rafter, Peroni?
How could I hang a Davis? I couldn't even lift him. Davis weighed about 200 pounds.
That's right, Peroni, but you're a pretty husky fellow. You could hoist him up there easy enough.
Yeah, but why were them three? They husky, too.
Yes, you're right, Peroni. All of our boys here are pretty husky. And I know which one murdered Ed Davis.
Ladies and gentlemen, you've heard the testimony of the suspects. You know all the facts and clues in tonight's mystery. Did you find the one clue that reveals the killer? In a minute, Larry Keating will question our four amateur detectives who were chosen from the studio audience about tonight's police findings. But now, it's time to relax for a moment. Okay, Larry?
Yes, Reed. And friends, whether you're relaxing at the close of a mystery thriller or taking it easy after a job well done, nothing hits the spot like Rainier Ale. Yes, Rainier Old Stock Ale. Full-bodied, mellow-aged, brewed with the know-how skill that makes each new taste a refreshing experience. For the most satisfaction at ease-up time, follow the lead of thousands of Westerners to the ale made best to taste best.
And that's Rainier Old Stock Ale, the West's favorite.
The West's favorite year after year for more than 10 years. Rainier Old Stock Ale. Rainier for good cheer.
And now, here's Larry Keating, ready to question our four amateur detectives regarding the evidence furnished by Inspector Burke.
Our amateur detectives tonight are Mr. Robert Malinger of Los Angeles, Mrs. Betty Covert of San Diego, Mr. Ray Peterson from Chicago, Illinois, and Mrs. Maud Taylor of Des Moines, Iowa. Before we get underway, I'd like to point out the rules of tonight's crime quiz. To each contestant who finds the murderer and the correct clue, Rainier Brewing Company will award a $50 savings bond. If our amateur detectives find the murderer but do not have the correct clue, they receive a $25 savings bond. And here's something else. To each contestant solving tonight's mystery, Rainier also awards a special gold detective certificate, suitably framed. The winners of this award rate the honor of joining the ranks of expert amateur detectives. And now, Inspector Burke has given me the basic evidence in tonight's mystery. Each contestant will be asked several questions. For answering correctly, Rainier Brewing Company will pay $5 in savings stamps. Now, let's review this evidence. First of all, we have Mr. Robert Malinger. Mr. Malinger, you're from Los Angeles, right?
That's right, sir.
I see you've made a lot of notes there on the back of the script. Is that it?
That's right.
You think you have the answer to the first question?
Well, I hope so.
We're going to find out right now. A man came aboard the diving barge and proposed a plan to Captain Charles. On what date was this?
Monday, April 22nd.
Have that written right down there, haven't you? Do you have the time written down, too?
No, I don't think so.
Well, forget it. It was 8 o'clock. I'll tell you that. Okay. But for having the date and day written down, you're going to get $5 in savings stamps courtesy of Rainier. Very good, Mr. Malinger. If you'll step aside, we'll ask Mrs. Covert to step to the microphone. You are doing this entirely from ear, are you, Mrs. Covert?
Yes, I am.
You didn't make notes?
No.
All right. Later, the captain's son, Chris, was offered a sum of money. How much money was offered?
Well, he was offered $1,000 at... he had $1,000 put in a sports page at his paper.
Well...
was to get $4,000 later if he...
In other words, he was to get $5,000, but $1,000 was offered inside the sports pages full of newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
He was going to get $5,000. I don't blame you. $5,000 is nothing in these times. I wouldn't bother to think about it myself either. But you get $5 in savings stamps from Rainier Brewing Company for knowing that he was to get $5,000 all
Thank
told.
You.
Now, Mr. Ray Peterson, please. Mr. Peterson, you are just going in for detective business in a small way, I see. You have just a small piece of paper there. Let's see how well you remember details. At the spot where the body was believed to be underwater, what was the water's depth? Just remembering this, you haven't that written down, eh?
68 feet.
Sorry, old man, it was 96 feet. Well, here, tell me, how long could the two divers stay underwater at this depth?
I didn't get that.
Well, we would have given you the $5 if you had known that answer. It was 96 feet in the first place, and 30 minutes was the length of time. Sorry, better luck next time. Now, Mrs. Maud Taylor. You're not nervous, are you? Mrs. Taylor, you're from Des Moines, Iowa, and you are a housewife, and you have some answers written down there. Let's hope you have this one. What person admitted tying up the victim, Ed Davis?
Oh, wait a minute.
No hurry, plenty of time. You say a word about Rainier, beer, and ale while you're looking at the situation over there. Made best to taste best. Of course, you knew that, Mrs.
Right.
Taylor. Beg pardon?
I don't know.
Well, time is up, and I'm sorry you don't know, but the answer is Captain Al Charles. Now, here is young Mr. Robert Malinger back again. Upon arriving at the cabin hideout, the police found Ed Davis dead. By what method did the victim meet his death?
From strangling.
He was strangled. You are right, sir. $5 more to you. Yes. And now, Mrs. Betty Covert again. Would you say the victim, Ed Davis, was a fairly large or small man?
Large.
Why do you think he was large?
Well, I remember them saying that it would take a very large man.
Do you recall how much he weighed? Any idea how much he weighed?
200.
200 pounds. Very good, Mrs. Kohler. Congratulations again. You get $5 in savings stamps. Mr. Ray Peterson. Jack Boyle claimed he followed Chris to the cabin. Upon entering, what did Jack say he saw?
Saw the body hanging.
Mm-hmm. And what did Jack say he immediately did?
Cut it down.
You are right, sir. $5 more to you, Mr. Peterson. Now, Mrs. Maud Taylor, the last question is yours. The police found another piece of rope that matched the rope around the victim's neck. What did the police particularly notice about both ends of this rope?
They matched.
And they were cut. And how were they cut?
Well, cut with a knife, I guess.
They were. And how were they cut? I mean, there's a little vernacular phrase used. They were cut as clean as what?
That's
a whistle. Very good. $5 to you, Mr. Taylor. Now, ladies and gentlemen, here is Inspector Burke to check the papers each amateur detective received at the start of tonight's mystery on which to write who they think committed the crime and the one clue that reveals the criminal.
Thank you, Larry. Well, I've checked the deductions on each of our amateur detectives, and I find that Ray Peterson of Chicago, Illinois, said that Frank Ferroni was the murderer. Sorry to say that he is wrong. Mrs. Betty Covert of San Diego, California, said that Captain Charles was the murderer. I'm sorry to say that she is wrong. However, Robert Malinger of Los Angeles, California, said that Jack Boyle was the murderer, but he gave the wrong clue, which is correct. But Mrs. Maud Taylor of Des Moines, Iowa, said that Jack Boyle was the murderer and also gave the correct clue.
Now let's see exactly what happened. We held a seaman, Jack Boyle, for the murder of Ed Davis. In attempting to quickly establish an alibi, Boyle made one fatal mistake. Jack said when he entered the cabin, he saw Davis tied to a rope hanging from the rafter. The body was hanging at least 3 feet from the ground. Jack claimed he immediately cut the body down. Then just as he finished untying the rope from the rafter, Chris rushed in and attempted to kill him. His story was an obvious lie, because when we examined the rope tied around Davis's neck, both ends of the rope had been cut clean as a whistle. Ed Davis was a solidly built man, weighing almost 200 pounds. Now, had Jack Boyle actually cut down the body of Davis as he claimed, the weight of the body would have caused the rope to be frayed. The knife could not possibly have cut the rope clean as a whistle. It was this one mistake that shattered Jack Boyle's alibi. Obviously, Ed Davis was not hanged from the rafter. Jack Boyle did not untie the rope from the rafter as he claimed. Actually, Boyle strangled Davis with a noose while the victim was bound hand and foot. Jack Boyle had been hired by Ferroni and Davis to toss the murder victim in the water. Later, Jack was the expert who planted the time bomb in the pocket of Chris's diving suit. After we recovered the body, Boyle went to the hideout. He was trailed at a safe distance by Chris. Boyle found Ed Davis tied up. Davis asked Jack to untie him. Jack refused, unless Davis and Ferroni pay him the promised money immediately. Davis threatened to expose Jack to the police. Enraged, Jack strangled Davis with a piece of rope. Frightened by Chris's sudden approach, Jack quickly cut the rope, attempting to make it appear he had found Davis hanging from the rafter.
Thank you, Inspector. And so tonight we find that Ray Peterson of Chicago has won $5 in saving stamps. $10 in saving stamps go to Mrs. Betty Covert of San Diego, California. Our second prize winner, $25 in savings bonds and $10 in saving stamps, goes to Robert Malinger of Los Angeles, California. And our first prize, a $50 savings bond and $5 in saving stamps, goes to Mrs. Maud Taylor of Des Moines, Iowa. Congratulations. And to each of the winners, Rainier awards a special gold detective certificate, suitably framed, honoring our guests as expert amateur detectives. And now, Inspector, what about next week's story?
In next week's story, Larry, two furtive figures hid in the shadows awaiting a third man. A gun was emptied point blank at the intended victim. When the police arrived, there was no body, no victim. To all appearances, the dead man had completely disappeared. This baffling riddle will be solved in the mystery of the phantom corpse. I'll see you then. Good night, everyone.
Good night, Inspector. So we bring to a close another Inspector Burke history drama, starring William Gargan and brought to you by Rainier Brewing Company of San Francisco and Los Angeles. Brewers of Rainier Club Extra Pale Beer and Rainier Old Stock Ale. All characters and incidents used on this program are fictitious. Any resemblance to actual persons or incidents is purely coincidental. This is Larry Keating saying goodnight for Rainier Brewing Company and inviting you to listen in again at the same time next week.
This is ABC, the American Broadcasting Company.
Hello there. This is CBS Mystery Theater's Corrine Orff. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
Big John and Steve materializing before your very ears once again. And we hope you enjoyed Murder Will Out. That was The Mystery of Death Under Sea from Sunday, July 8, 1945, over ABC and KGO originally. And that's going to wrap it up for our show where Steve and I scream out, "It's murder!
Murder!"
At midnight.
11:59 p.m. That's
right. And other than closing theme, which is by Mr. Paul Whiteman and his orchestra, and they'll be materializing behind us here very shortly. But first, I want to tell you what's coming up in the next couple of Glowing Dial episodes.
Pray tell, do tell us.
Yes, on May 14th, 2017, we have an episode where we celebrate Mother's Day and Memorial Day.
Mother.
And we have the Aldrich Family Anthology, The Whistler, and the Phil Harris Alice Faye Show to bring you there. On June the 4th, 2017, Steve and I celebrate Father's Day. We have an episode of The Lone Ranger. And then we dip into our grab bag for a few shows. We have a bold venture. We have Columbia Presents Corwin. And an episode of Dark Fantasy. So we want to make sure that you're there for both of those.
We'll wet their whistle.
That's right. And each episode of the podcast runs 3 weeks in length. So, Stephen, thank you so much for joining us once again.
Wonderful to be here, John.
It's been so wonderful.
I really try to
my schedule so I can accommodate our broadcasting needs. Yes.
Yep. And it's so wonderful to be able to have you back here almost on a pretty regular basis. Because everybody missed you while you were gone, believe me.
I heard. I had some wonderful comments about that, and that made me nice, a warm feeling in myself. Yes.
Yeah, because Jerry Hannigan's heard from people, and he even told you that you were missed. So thanks for being here and being part of this craziness since 1996. Can you believe that?
Oh, it's 21 years ago. My goodness.
Almost, yeah.
A whole generation has put up with us.
Well, we had a few hiatuses along the way there, but collectively.
Only if you're friendly. Hi, Atis. How are you today?
I'm fine.
My Atis just talked.
Your Atis.
My Atis.
Atis, you said.
My Atis, yes.
It sounded like you could have said something else a little naughtier.
Well, up yours.
Yeah, well, to you too, sir.
Oh, fine.
All right, that's going to wrap it up. I think Paul Whiteman is just about to materialize behind us here and start playing the closing theme. And I'm right. Well, we got some reminders before we get on out of here, folks. Remember all the great places that you can now hear the Glowing Dial Tri-Weekly Podcast. The Glowing Dial page, Jerry Handiga's Old Time Radio Network, iTunes, Google Play Music, YouTube, and the Internet Archive. Don't forget the Glowing Dial online store, plenty of great gift ideas with the Glowing Dial logos emblazoned on them. The Glowing Dial online bookstore, a great place to pick up stuff through our association with Amazon.com. Not just books, but videos, old-time radio shows. How about that that wonderful book, On the Air, The Encyclopedia of Old-Time Radio? It's by our good friend John Dunning. And you can still get the original book, Tune In Yesterday. You can get those used. So check that out. Do all your shopping at Amazon through our bookstore, if you would. Remember to join our blog and our Facebook page and get all the latest Glowing Dial news and information. Celebrity birthdays, well, if you need more of those, our good friend Ron Sales has got you covered. Go to glowingdial.com, click on links, and you'll see the link to Ron's blog. And tell him what a good job he's doing, and that Big John and Steve from the Glowing Dial sent you on over there. Our good friend Jerry Handigas helps this show in so many ways, and we want to tell you that he has an audio restoration service to help transfer and clean up those old recordings you may have. Get in touch with him also by clicking our links page. Jerry Handigas' Old Time Radio Network is a great place to hear Jerry's own show, our show, and many others in demand in streaming audio. And we want to thank our main sources of information on the shows that we bring you. Thank John Dunning, John over at OTRCat.com, and the good folks at Digital Deli 2 who are doing a wonderful job providing old-time radio information. And lastly, the Glowing Dial page, internet home of the Glowing Dial since 1996.